All right. Titletown Takes is back on the air. Episode 37. Ian Beauchesne joined alongside, as always, Connor Powell and Cam Urbowicz. Well, let's check in with the fellas and see how everyone's doing. We'll check in with Mr. Wickers first today. It's been a rough few hours here in the last 24 here for hockey fans here in New England. But, Cam, save whatever you have pent up for later on here. How are we doing, bud?
Not great, dude. Not great. I'll leave it at that. As the Bruins failed to show up, I will leave my statement at that. Not great.
All right. Let's check in with the third member of our group, Mr. Powell. How are we doing, bud?
Not great. It could be better. You know, world's imploding around us. 2020 keeps throwing punches at us. There's a hurricane coming to Louisiana and Georgia that for the first time in my life.
It hit late last night.
I saw that parts of it.
650,000 people are without power.
I was going to say, I don't know if this is real or not, but the first time in my life I saw that parts of where this thing was going to hit were going to be unlivable.
Yeah.
Unsurvivable.
So, that was the word, unsurvivable. So
it landed, as a category two.
Cat four.
No,
four.
It maxed out at a cat four, but it landed as a cat two.
Okay.
It dropped before it landed.
Yeah, but that's just, you know, 2020's throwing, you know, hurricanes and, you know.
What I wouldn't give to be in August.
Fire tornadoes. And
apparently there's an asteroid getting ready to start.
I'm rooting for it. I'm rooting for it, boys. You know, bring it on.
The day before the election, there's supposed to be a massive asteroid passing by this earth.
And there's another hurricane brewing up in the Caribbean. It's going to potentially hit Texas and Louisiana again.
By the end of the year, we go out like the dinosaurs. Just shit starts exploding and coming down and just, boom, take us all out.
So, all right, fellas. Well, we got a jam-packed episode here. We got a great interview coming your way. We're joined today by Freddie Coleman of Freddie and Fitzsimmons from ESPN Radio. Great interview. Great guy to talk to. A lot of good stuff coming your way. But we'll get to that in a little while. We do want to talk to you a little bit about some of the news that's come across the radar here in the last 45 minutes. For people that, you know, at this point are actually living under rocks and don't follow the news, the NHL, we're coming to you on Thursday recording. The NHL today announced that they're canceling games tonight on Thursday night between the Islanders and Flyers in Vegas and Vancouver, as well as Friday night's games between the Bruins and Tampa, which that's good news for the Bruins, but we'll get into that later on, as well as Colorado and Dallas in response to the events taking place in Kenosha, Wisconsin, late last week. Fellas, we'll open it up for thoughts on what this means and what this presents as a public relations image for the National Hockey League following what a lot of people thought was kind of a disrespectful move for the NHL in playing on Wednesday night after the NBA canceled their games, and we'll get into that as well.
Well, I feel that Jason Dickinson laid it out pretty nicely. Jason Dickinson, Stars player, had knelt during the national anthem during one of the round robin games, and he said, "Yeah, the NBA did the strike and didn't play or whatever." But he was like, "Yeah, but we've already woken up. We've already gotten ready. We're in game mode, and just to just stop and just not play, like, that wouldn't be fair to either team." He agreed that they might have should have stopped, but at that point both teams felt, he said, that it just wasn't the right thing to do at the time. So it's a good thing that on Thursday, Friday, they're not going to play today when, you know, no one has to get ready in that game mode and get, you know, have to reset and stuff. But
hold on, Cam. What's the difference between canceling it now today at 3 o'clock as opposed to yesterday at 4 o'clock when the Milwaukee Bucks all of a sudden were protesting their game and decided that they weren't going to come out and play.
Well, the Islanders had already started, so the game's
fair enough. But what happened?
The day's events have already been put in motion.
Yeah, but at the same time, the NBA's events had already been put into motion.
Yeah, but by the time just before the Bruins started, it had just been confirmed that every NBA team wasn't going to play because the NBA games were going to go late into the night. It wasn't like this is some big planned thing. I'm not going to crap on the NHL for playing.
No, I'm not. I'm not either.
It wasn't like this. It wasn't some big planned thing. It's just there's the video. It's just, you know, things happen, and you know what? They're stepping up. They're not playing today. They're not playing tomorrow. I think it might be a good move, and you know, it's, I don't know. I'm not qualified to speak on these things. I thought Anson Carter laid it out pretty well last night.
I thought he hit the nail right on the head.
Right
on the head. Said that, you know, I think we should play, and you know, stopping wouldn't really do anything. Doing things or action like opening up arenas to poll for polling places. The Toyota Center is going to do it. Dodger Stadium is going to do it. I think if TD Garden or Madison Square Garden or, you know, any NHL arena would be open to do this, this would be a big thing because voting is one of the ways we can enact change, even though, I don't know, I'm not going to get into a conversation about politics, but
no,
voting is one of the ways to enact change in this world. And if owners and players are more willing to open up these massive venues to accommodate way more people than an average town hall or a school would, it would create a lot of extra votes that could change things.
So this is all coming after today, and Pierre LeBrun about an hour ago had this tweet saying more than 100 players in the NHL bubble had a call this afternoon with Evander Kane and Matt Dumba, the two faces of the Hockey Diversity Alliance. Kane came out earlier today saying it's incredibly insulting as a black man in hockey, the lack of action and acknowledgement from the NHL. So obviously it was presented right at the forefront. Evander Kane made it very well public what his thoughts were on how the NHL handled the events following the NBA yesterday. And Cameron, I know you brought it up saying that, you know, everybody was already in game mode and this and that. So I understand that. Like I said, I'm not going to sit here and crap all over the NHL. I had no issue with them playing yesterday. I find no issue with them waiting to today to make the decision to come out and cancel games tonight and as well as Friday. So, you know, I think, and it's been brought up, canceling is not going to do anything. You know, it might make people aware a little bit more that there are bigger issues, but ultimately actions have to be taken by everyday citizens, not just the big name stars of professional sports leagues. Connor, what do you have to say?
I mean, just kind of echoing what you guys said. I don't think, you know, it's not playing to me is, I mean, it sends a message, sure. That, you know, we're not okay with what's going on. And, you know, whether it's the NHL or the NBA or whatever league it is, certainly it sends a message. But, I mean, I've just all day today been going back to Anson Carter's point of you cannot play all you want, but what realistically does that do besides not play? You know, you send a message all you want, but that doesn't do anything at the end of the day. You know, you can tell a baby or a dog to sit all you want, but if the dog doesn't sit, then, you know, it doesn't get anything done. So, you know, you need action here. You need to do something. And I don't know if like sports has an impactful thing, but at the end of the day, sports is a distraction from the real world. And, you know, we're starting to see that blend, which I think is a good thing. And, you know, we have to understand that there is some problems going on in the world, and we have to figure those things out. But, you know, I think not playing, it's not a bad thing. And I think, you know, you don't play these 2 days and then you move on. You do what you got to do. and you move on, and you take and, you know, learn from how you handled this time, get better next time. And, you know, like you said, Cam, the owners and everything are going to have to get involved here if they actually want action done, and opening up their arenas and stuff, and doing stuff in their communities individually. It's not going to just take one owner, one team to do one particular thing. It's going to be a group effort, and that's what it always should be. Is we're a country, we're a league in the NHL, the NBA. Everyone kind of has to be united here, and we're far from that right now.
Also, I just like to just point something out, and like, it's just semantics, but, and people can criticize the NHL for playing and stuff, but let's be real here. If the NBA had their way, everything would have gone on a schedule last night. The NBA had nothing to do with what the Bucks rightly decided to do. You know, people are like, oh, the NHL management didn't do anything. If the NBA had their way, everyone would have played yesterday and nothing would have happened.
Yep.
It's good on the Bucks because, I mean, I feel like people are overlooking that. It's like, oh, the NBA canceled the games. No, the players said, we're not playing. You're not going to make us play. And we're not going to accept a forfeit if you choose to give it. Because they went to the Magic. They said, hey, they're not playing. You want a forfeit? And they're like, no, we're not going to play either. So it's like, I don't want to hear any of this. Oh, and the NBA, the leadership, I mean, sure, they stuck by him, but that was only after they said, yeah, we're not playing. Just want to put that out there.
My big takeaway from this whole thing, right, fellas, and we've mentioned it a couple of times, you can play, you cannot play. And people can voice their opinion saying, oh, not playing is going to be a bigger impact. I think that's dead wrong. I think when you choose to go out and play, and look what the NBA's done, all right? They've taken the names off the top of the jerseys, and they've gone and they've allowed the players to choose from slogans or things that they feel are, you know, unequal in this world for white people and black people and African Americans.
But even that is like weird because the NBA said, yeah, you can put what you want in your jersey, but you have to take it from this list. You're not allowed to pick whatever you want.
That's
very hollow.
That's not my point.
I just want to point that out. Yeah.
That's great that they allowed him to do it. But you're taking away the biggest platform, or you're choosing to not use the biggest platform you have available to put out whatever memo or whatever agenda you want to put out there. And obviously right now it's the race inequality or racism that this country is facing and that this country has faced for over the last 150 years. This country is still stuck in the 1800s. It's 2020, but we're still living in 1820. You know, it's by choosing not to play, you're choosing to silence yourself, so to speak. Instead of going out and answering questions about a game, you can sit there and push whatever agenda that you want. We've heard LeBron in post-game press conferences just continue to bring up Breonna Taylor's name. You know, now you can look out and you can put out Jacob Blake's name out there. There are so many more ways to go about utilizing the platform and the media that you have, okay? And here we are on Thursday night. Tonight is the Republican National Convention, right? And I know we said that we didn't want to bring up politics, and I still don't, but I just want to touch on this very, very briefly. If the NBA chose to play tonight, players could have used this or platform to overthrow or push whatever that they want in front of media and kind of take away spotlight from the political world and show that, look, there are bigger issues in this world, and those that are higher up in power in government situations here aren't doing what needs to be done, and shit needs to change.
Too much hate going around everywhere. It is
too much hate, Connor, but I think something that people forget is it's too much hate. It's also lack of empathy.
Yeah.
It's all about, I mean, a lot of people in this world are me, don't care about you, going to step on 100%. You to get what I need to. And, I love you guys and, you know, all our friends, you know, we talk about all the time how much we love each other. And I try to treat everyone that I meet the same way that I'd like to be treated. And I think I do a good job of that, but.
Need more of it from everyone. It doesn't take one.
And I'll end it with the. I'll end my statement with this. I think there's a lot more that unites us than what drives us apart. But unfortunately, the things that drive us apart are put at the forefront. You know, well, I think there's I think there's a lot more that can, you know, bring us together. But I don't know. The world's just so messed up, and you know, maybe. I mean, it doesn't hurt to be optimistic, but, you know, sometimes it's hard to be.
So, well, one thing that is going to come out of this, fellas, is that there are going to have to be schedule changes because the Bruins were set to play game 4 on Friday night, and obviously now that's not going to happen. Game 5 was set to take place on Sunday, and game 6 and 7 were going to be on Tuesday and Wednesday. It would have been another back-to-back situation. So, obviously, there are going to have to be schedule changes made because you are not going to force guys to play 4 games in the span of 5 days. Does this benefit the Bruins moving forward?
I don't know what benefits the Bruins at this point. Just when you think you're starting to get a read on the team – they put out a performance like they did last night. I would like to think that a schedule change would help. Maybe there'll be less back-to-backs, you know, because I know game 6 and 7, if we get to that point, we're going to be back-to-back. So
they still may well be.
But, you know, to get a couple days rest here and, you know, possibly more days off is, I would think, a good thing. But I don't know how much good the Bruins are going to be doing soon.
So we'll move along. We've already kind of talked about it, but, you know, the NBA, again, postponed games on Wednesday night. It started with the decision from the Milwaukee Bucks, obviously, with the local connection from the events taking place in Kenosha, Wisconsin. They chose not to leave their locker rooms for warm-ups prior to the start of their game on Wednesday afternoon. With that said, Thursday night was set to see game 6 between the Denver Nuggets and Utah Jazz and game 6 between the Clippers and Mavericks, as well as game 1 of the Eastern Conference semifinals between the Toronto Raptors and the Boston Celtics. So with that being said, we're going to have to see schedule changes made here as well. Mm-hmm. You know, what do you think happens moving forward with the NBA?
Well, the players already said they want to finish the season. I mean, the only two teams that said no are the Clippers and the Lakers. And I know that the Lakers have, you know, LeBron, and the Clippers have Kawhi, and, you know, big ticket names. But I mean, I think we're going to continue on, but I don't know what the schedule is going to be. I think something that may help the NBA a little bit is family and friends of the players are hoping to enter the bubble on Monday. So that may bring some, you know, calm in a sense, maybe not to the outside world, but to themselves. Like, I know Jaylen Brown was very shaken by this, you know, along with some other players, but, you know, we're Boston based. So I know Jaylen was, he's very well-spoken. He likes to speak his mind, and, you know, he's very good at it. You know, we all know he came from Cal, and, you know, one of the knocks on him, unfortunately, coming out of the draft was he was too smart. He proves it every time he walks up to that microphone and that doing a press conference, man. He's just so good at, you know, he's great at the game he plays. He's great at what he speaks as well. And I just, you know, I'm a big Jaylen fan. Connor knows. But, you know, we're with you, bud. You know, we're with them all. And, you know, I think the NBA season will continue. I just don't know what the timeline would be.
So Woj came out today and announced that the players have voted and they are going to continue the season. But a name that's been floating around there right now as far as being a liaison between NBA players from the association as well as league owners is Michael Jordan. Obviously, Michael Jordan is the owner of the Charlotte Hornets. He is the only black majority leader or black owner in the entire league. NBA PA President Chris Paul told ESPN that in advance of the owners' meetings, they had to get a better understanding of what the players hope to achieve. And Michael Jordan, you know, he reached out, and I think that's huge for the NBA. You know, you have the only black majority owner, and he wants to be part of the solution and not a part of the problem.
Yeah, well said. I think it's, you know, not good. Not good.
So, and people are going to listen to a guy like Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
Yeah. Got a quote here. Not sure who it's from. It's in an article on ESPN from Jackie McMullen. One of the senior writers says, Michael is the perfect person to be in this role, said a league official. Who has been privy to the discussions on what should happen next. He's been a high-profile player who has won championships. He's also the owner of a small market team. He has great credibility with both players and owners. So, again, I think this is a big thing for the NBA moving forward to have a guy like him who not only played in the league but has such a big stake as an owner of a team to become part of the solution. Moving forward. Well, fellas, I, as much as we sit here, you know, and we like to talk sports, we enjoy it. That's why we do it. You know, it's a common thread between all of us. We do acknowledge that there are bigger issues in this world. We talked about it the other night on pregame. We mentioned that there are issues bigger than us. And, you know, from all of us here at Titletown Takes, we do acknowledge that there needs to be more conversation about what is wrong in this world. There are people that are not treated as equals. And in order to truly find happiness in our daily lives, things need to change. We can't continue to live, like I said, we can't continue to live like we're in the 1820s. You know, we have come such a long way as a civilization. We've come such a long way as a country. But unfortunately, there's this one rooted problem that continues to just show how terrible and how cruel people can be to others on a day-to-day basis. With that said, you know, change needs to happen. It needs to happen sooner rather than later. And, you know, we're not about to sit here and cast shame on these leagues for wanting to postpone games to show these issues that need to be talked about. So, again,
everybody be excellent to each other. I said it in a show earlier. I'm going to say it now. You know, it's a Bill and Ted quote, but I think it sums up what the world needs to happen. Everybody be excellent to each other.
Yeah, and you talked about it too, Cam. Treat others the way you want to be treated. Simple, mm-hmm. Simple as that. And lastly, I'll just say it. As son of a police officer, Connor, you're in the same boat. Unfortunately, there's a couple of bad eggs out there that cast a huge black cloud over police and law enforcement's not only here in this country, but around the world. Obviously, you know, the United States isn't the only country where issues like this arise. But, you know, to sit here and cast shame on men and women who dedicate their lives to go out and protect and serve, truly protect and serve people and do good for your local neighborhoods, do good for your states, do good for your country. It is wrong. You know, there are people out there that are power hungry. There are people out there that when they get the badge, you know, they hide behind that. They feel that, you know, the badge is a sense of entitlement and they can get away with whatever they want. And that's not true of a large majority of people that take on the role of public service and public defense out there for us. So that also has to be said, that, you know, just because there are a couple of bad eggs in the carton doesn't mean that you can't use the rest of them to make a good omelet. There are plenty of good people out there in this world, and those people that go out there to do good need to be spotlighted just as much for the good that they do than as well as the people that are out there causing these issues that we face today. So with that said, let's move along. Bit of a happier note. We got a great interview coming your way. We were very pleased to be joined by a great radio personality on ESPN Radio. For anybody out there that doesn't get the chance to tune in, you can tune in on the ESPN Radio app as well as Sirius XM. He'll bring it up. He'll tell you where and when you can tune in. We're going to send it over to our interview with Freddie Coleman from the Freddie and Fitzsimmons radio show on ESPN Radio. We'll be back here on Titletown Takes right after this. All right. Today's guest was born in Brooklyn, New York. He's a graduate of Mansfield University of Pennsylvania, where he graduated kind of like us fellows with a degree in mass communications. We specified in media and communications. He also joined the Mounties as a walk-on with the football team, something he takes tremendous pride in to this day. He has spent time on air at WPDH-FM and WCZX-FM in Poughkeepsie. He can now be heard alongside his partner, Ian Fitzsimmons, on ESPN Radio starting at 11 p.m. Eastern. It is our pleasure to welcome to the Titletown Takes podcast, Mr. Freddie Coleman. Freddie, thanks for joining us, man.
My pleasure, Ian. My pleasure, Connor. My pleasure, Cameron. How are you guys doing?
Can't complain right now, man. Now that we're it's been a little bit. We've been focusing more on that sports back, so it's good to be back on the interview grind here.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Just having sports back just makes everybody feel better, even though we still got a ways to go before there's some kind of normalcy, whatever that's going to be.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's been a big talking point for us, Freddie, and it's a good point to kind of jump off. You know, you go back to March, right, and, you know, it was a Wednesday night. I remember it specifically. I was playing in my men's pickup league and for hockey, and all of a sudden I get notifications on my phone following my ice time. The NBA is officially shut down, and from there it was just a roller coaster of ups and downs. Oh, this is getting canceled. Now that's getting postponed. What was it like for you being on air nationally at that time or around that time when things kind of started to, you know, de-escalate as far as athletics were getting into it? Because we were getting into the heyday of our sports calendar. You know, we had March Madness coming up. We had the Masters. We had NBA
best time of the year
and hockey playoffs. It was great. So what was it like for you?
I wanted to try to say that it didn't feel like the world was ending, but it felt like the walls were collapsing from that standpoint, because to your gentleman's point, there was no doubt that we were really getting into the really teeth of everything with the college basketball tournament, with conference tournaments leading into the big dance. You had the NBA leading into the playoffs, the NHL leading into the playoffs, the NFL draft being around the corner, and it seemed that everything just came to a complete shutdown. And I think the biggest thing about that was the unknown. People did not know exactly what was going to happen or how you could find a way to take steps to have basketball coming back, or the NHL. When was Major League Baseball going to start? How was that going to affect football? So I think that was the one thing that really kind of shook us a little bit. It wasn't so much the shutting down, because you had to believe at a certain point that that was going to happen in any or all sports. But the fact that the
You talk about the unknown, and I mean that kind of affected us as well, and into where we're trying to crank out an hour, 2 hour podcast once a week, and you know we're trying to come out. I mean, you know it as a radio guy too. You try to, you know, bring takes to the table, and there's certain aspects of that where you're bringing a take, but at the end of the day, you say, well, we'll see. So how was that kind of adjustment period of, you know, kind of. You go from, okay, we're going to see tomorrow night when the game happens, to, well, we don't know when we're going to get sports back anytime soon. So how'd you go from kind of that constant stimulation to sports and a sports radio show to just not knowing when sports are going to come back?
Well, to me, kind of the best thing about it was you get really creative, because you can have the play to hits mentality, what's going on at that particular time or what could be happening at that later time. But that really was able to push ourselves creatively to say, okay, what storylines are out there that we know we can sink our teeth into? Not trying to make the unknown known, but what was in front of us, that's what we focused on. And I think a big part of that was, for example, Tom Brady leaving the New England Patriots to go to Tampa Bay. Normally, a storyline like that is going to be huge. It might last a day or two. But so many different avenues were leading us to that, and so many different avenues leading us away to go to different things that we could discuss that. So that became our mindset, that if something happened, there was also encouraged us to seek out other things or other people that might have been page 8, page 9 when it comes to the topic line, when it comes to the topic tree. All of a sudden, you move them up to page 2 and page 3. And what we were able to learn was that there were so many different things and different things that we were doing that were out there that we were able to say, yeah, let's sink our teeth in it, or let's get that person on. But you were able to get a Bob Bowles beyond in charge of the Big 12 to get his thoughts. This way, people weren't just hearing from us. They were hearing us interview people that were going to be decision makers about when sports were going to come back, or people that knew decision makers, allowing to find out when sports are going to come back. So those were different things we were able to shift our focus and make that work for us. So now when sports came back, we had that in addition to, and I think it's going to expand our show even better and make it even further.
Perfect jumping off point here. Let's just go back to, we'll call it 3 or 4 weeks ago when the NBA really started to pick up steam and their season restart got underway. How has it been for you? There's going to be a little bit of an enjoyment factor because now it's a little easier for you to communicate with listeners. It's easier for you to find, you know, generalized talking points that the average fan can kind of tune in to a game for 10 or 15 minutes here or there during the course of their day, and then they could relate to it listening to your show. Has it been easier for you now with everything coming back, or do you find because there's so much of a sports overload, there's almost too much to talk about during one night of your show?
Oh, God, there's never too much to talk about. I like to say greed is good, like the old movie line from Wall Street, especially more than ever before. We didn't know exactly what kind of greed we're going to have to dive into when it comes to sports. As far as we're concerned, Ian, there's no such thing as too much of too many sports being back, because look at the alternative when there was zero things going on and there was nothing to talk about in terms of live sports. So we never looked at that and said, man, this is going to be too much, having the NBA, Major League Baseball, the NHL, and football around the corner. We were doing the Hallelujah Chorus like we were in church from that standpoint. We never looked at it from the standpoint that there was going to be too many things to talk about. But the one thing that I tell people all the time, if you can find certain things and really, really bring it to the table, or different versions of what's going on, all of a sudden it's not just about the live game being back. It's not just about the score. For example, one of the coolest things I've seen since we've gotten sports back was what the Phoenix Suns were able to do, having family members, having starting introductions for their players a couple of days ago. That was something that we would not have seen without the bubble environment. But it became a storyline and something that people were going to be talking about. So we couldn't wait to talk about that and really say, this is really cool that these guys away from their families, and now they feel that little bit of a closer connection, even though they're still away. And the Lou Williams wings thing, I mean, come on now. We couldn't have asked for anything better than that when something like that happens, where all of a sudden he says he went to get wings, but he wasn't at the strip club, and nobody gave him a lap dance from that standpoint. So it seemed like something different was always happening involving an athlete, involving a team. So it to me, it added to the storyline with sports coming back and not just about the final score, not just about who did this or who did that. All other things were happening. We were saying, okay, that's part of the storyline. We got to talk about that. And what are our takes on that? How do we feel about that? So it's been pretty cool not having, so I say having everything back, but not believing that you can't cover everything, because you really can't. But there's certain things you can really say, yeah, let's go into that. Let's dive into that and see if we can make that work.
Now, Frey, let's just take a step back here a little bit and just let's can you tell us a little bit about just your journey to where you're at now, and, you know, how you got your first big break, and just kind of talk us through your story getting through kind of the dog days of radio to where you are now.
Well, long before you guys were born, there was no such thing as sports talk radio, because the first sports talk radio station was, of course, WFAN And that was back in 1987. I remember that first came on board. I said, so let me get this straight. There's this radio station that's going to be talking about sports 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, even on Christmas. Where do I sign up for that? But I never thought in a million years.
It's that a beautiful thing.
It was a fantastic. I remember that was such a story, gentlemen, in New York, that it led the news in New York the night, the first day that WFAN was on the air, because Jim Lampley did the first show in the history of really sports talk radio from a local level that were able to trampoline off of that. So that became big news in New York. But I never thought in a million years that I would be involved in sports talk radio. I just never, ever put that into my consciousness, because I wanted to be that next great FM radio DJ. The people that I grew up listening to were people that I listened to each and every night growing up as a kid in Brooklyn, New York, whether it was Chuck Leonard on 98.7 KISS or Frankie Crocker and Ken Spiderweb on WBLS or Scott Muni and Pete Fortital on WNEW. I treated them as if they were the stars of the world, because they were stars of me each and every night. So that's where my journey got started, wanting to be in music radio and wanting to be that person. And I started in Top 40 Radio in Portland, Maine. And I advise anybody that if you have a chance to get your first job, whatever that job is going to be, invest yourself in the city. You'd be amazed how much that can add to your radio show, where that brings that relatability, and also people get a chance to know you and what you think about things. And I thought Portland, Maine, where I was able to get my first paying radio job, was a great training ground and a proving ground for me. So I was able to go from Portland, Maine, then to Poughkeepsie, New York, where I learned so much again. Then I go into New York City, where I'd always wanted to work doing soul music for a classic soul station. And then I was able to do a kind of a hybrid thing, going back to the Hudson Valley, working in radio and in TV, working in Wappingers Falls in that area, also Poughkeepsie as well. And when I finally got to Albany, New York, working for Fox Sports Radio and also a classic rock station on the weekend at Pix 106, I said to myself, you know, I'm pretty good now. I'm in a market like this, great area, great passionate sports fans, doing that and music at the same time. I was ready to stay in Albany for more than a minute. I was not planning to leave anywhere. And I tell people all the time, if you want God to laugh at you, say, I got a plan. And God's going to say, yeah, that's not the plan that I want for you. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, ESPN Radio, they came calling. A buddy of mine told me that they had an opening for game night at that time, and he thought I'd be perfect for it. And I don't know what he heard, but I said, you know, what do I got to lose? So I went in for an audition, not thinking anything. I said, I'm going to be the best Freddie Coleman I can be. And whatever happens is whatever's going to happen. Because I was in a no-lose situation. If I didn't get it at the job at ESPN Radio, I still had a great job that I was going back to. And 16-plus years later, here I am still doing something that I really enjoy and still get a kick out doing each and every night.
Let's just go back to – oh, go ahead, Cam. Go ahead.
So Freddie, I was just looking through some stuff, and just on your ESPN page, it says you've been on First Take. What's it like doing something like – what's it like working – with like Stephen A, what's that experience like?
One of the things I'll say about that show, as much of a monolith and a behemoth that it really because they said, well, hey, why don't we give that guy a shot? We know he loves radio. How about we have a chance to fill in on our First Take? And it's been a glorious marriage ever since, and things go in cycles. But the one thing I learned from both of those guys, they said, don't come out here trying to compete with us. We've already established that beachhead. Just be you and have everything, and we'll react to you and you'll react to us. And the best piece of advice that they could give, not just to me, a veteran in the business, but to anybody else. Skip and Stephen A told me, don't worry about being the second us. Be the first you, be the Freddie Coleman that we hear on radio, and everything's going to work out fine. Whether we agree or disagree with you, it's going to be for a lively discussion. It's going to be an engaging discussion. And that's exactly what happened. So anytime I get a chance to fill in up First Take, I never lose sight of the fact that I'm Freddie Coleman from ESPN Radio, but you're getting the best Freddie Coleman you can possibly get. And how you react to that, I'm completely good with it. But that was the best piece of advice. Don't worry about the overreaching effect of First Take. Just be you and be a part of that and enjoy being a part of that, and everything usually takes care of itself.
Let's just go back to talking about game night on ESPN Radio and your time doing that. You were a football guy. You talked about it. I caught an interview that you did a while back with your alma mater, and you talked about what it meant to join the football team as a member and become a walk-on. You know, you said that you – you weren't exactly 100% confident, but you knew it was something that you wanted to do. It was something that you felt needed to be done. What was it like being able to then take that experience and use it on a national level to cover the National Football League, that a brand that is known around the globe?
Well, the one thing I always tell people, you can't be afraid of competition, and you're going to have to deal with competition in every facet of your life, whether you graduated from Duke, whether you graduated from Syracuse, or if you graduate from Mansfield University like I did, that competition factor is always going to be there. So that's the approach that I bring, no matter what sport it is, whether it's football, basketball, whatever that is. And that's the one thing I love about the NFL, for example. That competition never sits down. It never stops. And you always have to try to be ahead of everybody else to just win a playoff game or have a great regular season, much less winning a championship. And those same principles apply to what we do and how we go about things. I never want people to say this, man, he mailed it in. I never want people to ever say that about when they listen to me or whether they watch me or filling in on First Take or whatever show. They don't have to agree with what I'm saying or bring to the table, but they're never going to question my 100, because I always keep it 100 and bring it 100 each and every time. And I think a big factor is that playing football or playing any kind of sport or being involved in the competitive atmosphere, it's always going to help you, because it'll teach you a lot about competition out there. But more important, guys, it'll teach you a lot about yourself, because you'll figure out exactly, okay, that works for me, that doesn't work for me. Yeah, I gave it my best shot, or the next time, you know what, maybe I need to leave that for somebody else. Those kind of things are always going to work. You may not get the result that you're looking for. Everything's not going to be rainbows and butterflies. Those aren't going to be the kind of results all the time that's going to happen. But I think because you're part of a competitive atmosphere, you learn exactly how to deal with those failures that are going to happen, learn from those lessons. And the next time a success happens, you can say, okay, I really appreciate that, because I dealt with that. I was able to overcome that. And now I'm able to embrace that success and really not make it bigger than it is, but not try to just saw soon and say, oh, that was okay. I think having a competitive atmosphere in any point of your life only helps you professionally and personally. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
Now, I mean, you've given us a lot of advice already here. But, you know, just for some younger people getting through the communication field and trying to get into the sports communication area, like what is one word of advice, or not one word, but what's one thing you would tell a younger person trying to get into, whether it's sports radio, sports communications in general, or sports TV? Like, what is one thing you would tell a young person like that?
I tell young people all the time, and I don't want to say it's a generational thing, because I think it's gone through each and different kinds of generation. But I tell younger people all the time, it's okay to be fearless. And that doesn't mean conceited. That doesn't mean overconfident. That doesn't mean being a pain in the you know what. There are plenty of people that don't have the biggest mouths in the world, but were fearless. For example, Bill Gates, for example, is not the biggest mouth guy in the history of mankind, but he trusted his instincts and was fearless to say, what have I got to lose by trying this? I think so many times it's easy to talk yourself out of something than to allow yourself to be a part of something. And I think, especially more than ever before, I think a lot of young people are so worried that they put themselves out there. What's going to be the reaction on social media? What's going to be the reaction from their peers? Or will somebody in their family say that's a bad idea? So you allow yourself to devalue yourself, but you allow other people or circumstances to devalue you. And then you don't get a chance to try something that you've always wanted to do, or that you always wanted to be a part of, or a group that you wanted to be a part of. It's very easy to say, I don't think I can try that. It should be a lot easier to say, what have I got to lose by not trying that? What do I have to lose by not trying to be a part of something like that? And I think sometimes I love the human mind. The human mind to me is the greatest instrument of all time, because it can really affect you and affect your life. But at the same time, the human mind never gets in your way. You get in the way of your human mind, because the mind is always wanting to be a sponge and learn so many different things and be a part of different things. People stop their minds from thinking or elevating their thinking process because they talk themselves out of something, or they talk themselves into a situation that they know is not good for anybody. The human mind is going to be there to help you. But if you're not helping yourself, then how are you going to be a better person, no matter what that's going to be? So that's the piece of advice I tell younger people all the time. It's okay to be fearless. That doesn't mean you're supposed to show fear or have that kind of fear, because if you're afraid to ask somebody something, you got to realize the worst thing you can say is no. And then you move on to somebody else to see what you can get and see if you can make that work for you.
Well, I want to ask, because you brought up your time on radio as a DJ and a musical DJ, and how you had some influencers or role models when you were younger. What's the picture hanging up behind you? Is that Hendrix?
Oh, yeah. Jimi Hendrix.
Yes.
Excuse me while I kiss the sky all the time.
All right. All right. Let's move along on to a musical note then. Who are some of your favorite musical artists out there?
See, the one thing about music with me, there are way too many people that I love. It could be the Beatles. It could be Van Morrison. It could be the Rolling Stones. It could be Al Green. It could be Michael Jackson, Prince, Jimi Hendrix behind me. I was very blessed to grow up in a family that never allowed my musical taste to be completely, completely narrowed. I mean, my dad and I, growing up in Brooklyn, New York, we watched Hee Haw every Saturday night at 6 o'clock on Channel 11 because we love country music. We love Johnny Cash. We love Hank Williams. We love Hank Snow. We love Dolly Parton. So my musical taste is so eclectic because that's the kind of household I grew up in. Now, there's certain things my mom and dad would never wrap their heads around. The first time I brought reggae into the house, my dad was like, yeah. The first time that I played Run DMC in the house, my mom looked at me like I had six heads. But they never allowed me to say, okay, you shouldn't listen to that because your mom and dad don't like it. My mom and dad said, if that's what you have and that's what you want, that's completely, completely fine. And there are plenty of times that I would be listening to something and my mom and dad would ask, who is that? For example, when they first heard Bob Marley, my dad became a fan of him, even though he's not a reggae fan. The first time my mom heard Robert Cray, she said, who was that? I said, that's so-and-so as a blues musician. So I was really, really blessed to grow up in a household where my mom and dad may not have appreciated some of the music I was listening to, because I can only imagine a look on their face the first time I played Immigrant Song by Led Zeppelin in their household. I'm sure their heads want to spin around off its axis from that standpoint. But they never allowed me to say that you shouldn't listen to that in our house, just probably keep the volume down. So I never have like a favorite artist here and there. I have so many different people that I love to listen to. And I think that's a big part of who I am, is that I'm allowed to let my mind be free and follow along and say, okay, that's country, can't listen to it. That's jazz, can't listen to it. My mom and dad wouldn't allow that to happen in their house, whether they liked the music or did not like the music.
So, Freddie, with the NBA and the NHL, we've seen some surprising results as leagues have started to come back. Obviously, the Phoenix Suns, they're 7-0, I believe.
Undefeated, yep.
They need a win today and a Grizzlies loss to the Bucks to make it in. Do you think that trend continues as the playoffs continue? Do you think we could get some stunners as the playoffs begin?
The one stun I thought was going to happen that a lot of people have started to come around is the Portland Trailblazers, because I guarantee you, plenty of teams in the Western Conference do not want to see that team into the playoffs, because Damian Lillard is a man possessed. But getting Nurkic points, back, Nurkic back helps them. Carmelo Anthony has been a godsend, especially in the defensive end and rebounding the basketball. But when you have a guy, Damian Lillard, that can put a team on his back in a series, that's the most dangerous person that you have to deal with. So I was going to say the Portland Trail Blazers are going to be a surprise. I think it may be to the point now that if they don't get into the playoffs as a play-in game, winning that play-in game, that it may not be a surprise they don't get in. I think the one thing I'm looking forward to seeing in the East, who can be that team that can challenge Toronto, Milwaukee? And I think that team could be Boston. But keep an eye on these two teams, the Indiana Pacers and the Miami Heat. The Miami Heat are the kind of team that the Philadelphia 76ers thought they were going to be by tanking, but Miami never tanked. They were able to be a fluid basketball team and organization by adapting when LeBron James left and then when Dwayne Wade left. And look at the young talent that they have, whether it's Tyler Hero or Duncan Robinson or Bam Adebayo. They still got Goran Dragic, who's one of the older guys there, but they fastened a young team of snipers around and a veteran basketball team. That's a team that could surprise in the East because they're young talent and nobody believes in them. And the Indiana team, if Oladipo is even 70%, they play hard all the time. And TJ Warren, he's been an and-one mixtape every night for the Indiana Pacers until he went up against Jimmy Butler in the Miami Heat. And we saw how that ended from that standpoint. But those are two teams that keep an eye on them in the East. And I think the one team to keep an eye on the West, especially if reasonably healthy, are going to be the Utah Jazz. You may beat them in the series, but they're going to take years off your life. That even if you beat them in a series, you may not have anything left to play a team in a next series if it's in the semifinals of the Western Conference or the Western Conference Finals or the NBA Finals. Donovan Mitchell is so good, but Joe Ingles is a Swiss Army knife for that basketball team. And Quinn Snyder does an excellent job coaching that basketball team. That's a team that if they got to the Western Conference Finals could be a surprise, but they play so hard that no one should be surprised if Utah is able to do that.
You brought up the Celtics, and obviously with us being a Boston area-based podcast, it's a big thing for us to talk about.
Yeah, we got a New York guy on here. I don't know what we're doing.
Hey.
We can't talk about the Knicks till about 2050.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
We don't want to talk about the Red Sox till about 2050 as well.
That's true, too.
But, no, you brought up the Celtics, and obviously there was a lot of question marks around how this younger team was going to respond after such a layoff. I mean, they had been arguably right behind Toronto for large portions of the season. Obviously, it was – you know, Nick Nurse has put together a special unit up there in Toronto. We've seen what they've been able to accomplish over the last couple of years. But we've seen guys like Jaylen Brown and Jason Tatum improve on their seasons that they had prior to the stoppage. I mean, Tatum made the All-Star team, and he seems to have gotten better. Jaylen Brown got snubbed from the All-Star team, a lot of people feel, and he seems to have taken that and maybe used that as a little bit of motivation. What's a key for the Celtics to give not only Toronto a run for their money in a potential second-round matchup if they can get past Philly in the first round, but how do they make it difficult on this Bucks team that just seems to have been a buzzsaw all year long? I mean, Giannis the last couple of days has kind of started to lose his cool. There was an incident with Daniel Tice in the Celtics game. He's headbutted who was it the other day from
Wagner.
Wagner, yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I was trying to remember. I remember where he played college ball. I just couldn't remember the name.
Yeah.
How do you see that kind of playing out for the Celtics down the road?
If they rebound, they're going to be hard to deal with, because when they rebound, they think they can get out and go and have guys run the spots. Kemba Walker's health is going to be paramount. There's no doubt about that. But they're always at their best when they can rip and run. And we've seen what they've been able to do, because they got enough guys that can fly down the court, that can get to the front of the rim. They're very good at sharing the basketball, because usually young teams – are fighting for the basketball, saying, okay, you got the last four times, I got to get it this time. That seems not to be the case. When Jaylen Brown's going good, Jason Tatum and Kemba Walker, go do your thing. Go out there and do it. When Gordon Hayward, who's been a perfect complement because he doesn't need the ball, but he's become very efficient because so much attention has been focused on Jason Tatum, Jaylen Brown, and also Kemba Walker. Now he's been able to flourish and shine a little bit more, not having that kind of pressure on him. But they're able to rebound and get out and run. There's not a lot of teams that can hang with the Boston Celtics, because they're a youthful team, but they're so smart and intelligent about where they need to go and get to those spots. Toronto, we know what they can do. A lot of people talk about Milwaukee was going to cruise through the East, and I said, I don't know. It was that team up north wants to show people that it wasn't just Kawhi Leonard and the Kawhi Leonardettes winning that championship last year, and we've seen what they've been able to do. And the one thing that Boston and Toronto share a lot in common, they are so good at getting players and making them better because of the structure of their organization. A lot of people wonder, okay, Jason Tatum, a high draft pick, how good is he going to be? He's a burgeoning superstar. There's no doubt about that. He may be closer to being a superstar than a lot of people want to talk about. They drafted Jaylen Brown, and many people thought they reached for him, but look what he's been able to do. They take a chance on Kemba Walker, get him out of purgatory in Charlotte, and bring him to this basketball team. He's been the perfect leader, the anti-Kyrie Irving that you needed on this basketball team. Both Boston and Toronto have been so good that when they get players, they seem to be able to raise their level, that whatever weaknesses they have, you can't really take advantage of that in mismatches. And whatever strengths they have, they've been able to accent those strengths to make them a better basketball team individually and collectively.
You're a New York guy. What are your thoughts on Kyrie?
Here's the thing with Kyrie Irving. I think Kyrie is too smart for his own good, because he's not a dumb guy, but at times he says dumb things and does dumb things. But it's coming from a place of curiosity and intelligence. So I clearly understand, other than the flat earth thing, that's just crazy. That's Kanye-esque what he was talking about from that standpoint. But there are plenty of things that he challenges the status quo that I don't have a problem with. Because if you're not going to say something, he's not just saying something just to say it a lot of times. He's saying because he's curious and he wants an answer, especially when it comes to him as a basketball player and also other basketball players in the NBA. So he may have that kind of streak. You look at him side and go, dude, I don't know. I don't know where you're coming from. But it's not coming from a place of stupidity with him. It's always coming from a place of honesty. It's always coming from a place of intellect. And it's coming from a place of curiosity. Now, the casual person is not used to that, especially with an NBA superstar. A lot of people want their NBA superstars to be a Michael Jordan or LeBron James. You can speak on certain things, but there's a line. With Kyrie Irving, there's no such thing as a line. If he believes that there's something out there that needs to be transparent, he wants to find an answer to it. I just think a guy like him, as mature as he can be, at a certain point, when does he realize there are times to be Kyrie and there are times you have to defer? And I think if he was able to do that to Boston Celtics at the time, he would still be there. But when you want what you want and people are going to give it to you, you feel you have the power of church and state. So that's why Boston said, we're not going to do that anymore. And Kyrie, he bit a hasty retreat to go to the Brooklyn Nets. Hey, more power to him. But at a certain point, if he's too much Kyrie, how's Kevin Durant going to handle that? Because Boston handled it well by dealing with it. But until he got to a point and then Jaylen Brown said, you can't talk to us that way, thinking that we're just going to follow along. They let it be known. And maybe Kyrie didn't like that. What if he's like the Kevin Durant, who's a bigger superstar than he is? Then how's that going to fly in Brooklyn? And we'll see how much that intelligence and honesty will have to come to the surface when it comes to a very inquisitive guy like Kyrie Irving.
Just to bring it back to your Celtics point, I think the reason why the Celtics play such good unselfish basketball is just the Brad Stevens style in general. I feel like people forget he went to back-to-back national title games with Butler, a team that is a small school, but they were able to get decent talent. And I think also people forget that the Stevens took a team that basically only had Isaiah Thomas as a star to the number one seed in the East the year that they lost in five to the Cavs. And I think the big thing on Stevens and just Celtics in general is when they had Kyrie last year, the problem was Stevens wasn't big enough to deal with that as a coach. Sure. Everybody had to get their touches, and that led to a lot of congestion. With Kemba in, it leads to a lot of free-flowing basketball. And if you can get that free-flowing with the talent, I think it can lead to big things. Because Kemba, I talked about this on a Bruins post-game show we had done. First game of the year, Celtics versus Philly, and Jaylen Brown had missed like his first 10 shots. And he walks up to Kemba and he says, man, I'm sorry, I'm trying to hit him. I just, you know, it's not working. And Kemba told him, hey, keep shooting. If you keep shooting, you have a chance to get back in rhythm. If you stop, you've lost all confidence. If this was Kyrie, Kyrie would have said, yeah, stop shooting, give me the ball. And I think Kemba has just added a huge boost to this team.
Yeah, sometimes the biggest curse and the biggest strength of a superstar is the fact that you believe you can conquer all tall buildings in a single bound. For example, a guy like Kobe Bryant, he always believed that the ball was in his hands. He was going to find a way. But as he got older and older, he realized, I can still do these things, but I really got to trust my teammates a little bit more. That's why he was able to win championships with Shaquille O'Neal, and he had that whole blow up the Lakers. You can have a superstar on your basketball team, but that does mean other guys can be left out. I think a perfect epitome of that is a guy like Steph Curry. Steph Curry, even when he was going good before Kevin Durant, he knew that, hey, Klay needs to touch the ball, I need him. Or Draymond Green needs to do this. Or other guys need to do that. Even when he was not going good the first time they won a championship, he wasn't trying to force shots. Once he got going, then everybody else followed. Then Kevin Durant comes along, and he wasn't interested in trying to compete for touches. He's like, hey, if the ball runs through that guy and we win championships, I'm good with it because I'm still going to give mine, but not at the expense of a team. You can have a free-flowing system with a superstar if the superstar clearly understands it can't just be about him. Now, you're going to need that guy down the stretch. And if Kyrie Irving been able to figure that out in his mind, hey, down the stretch, the ball's going to run through me, and I can create shots for myself and other people, then we're going to be a better basketball team. But when you're so gifted like he is, he hasn't really learned yet, in my opinion, that it's okay to take over games, but then if I'm going to do that, if I'm double team or triple team, I got to trust I get the ball to my teammates. Even if they don't knock down the shot the first time, I can't just keep the ball away from them because at that point they're not going to be ready for it, and then they're going to get stink eye from him because they were not ready for it. You can have both if the superstar believes in his team and the team knows that, especially when crunch situations happen.
Freddie, I want to get your take on the NHL and how things have been going up in Toronto and Edmonton. They came out earlier this I can't remember. It was early this week or last week.
It was Tuesday, I believe.
It was Tuesday that they came out with it. Zero positive test results out of the more than 7,000 tests that they have conducted.
I think it's the fifth wave as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's not the first one that they've done. You want to just speak to kind of how the NHL not only is handling it now, but kind of how they held back when you kind of saw a lot of other leagues, such as the NBA, rushing into the Orlando decision to get down there and claim that spot, and then how it's kind of improved in the way that the product is presenting on TV for fans that have to sit and watch at home.
Here's the best thing that's happened for the NHL. They've had more fights in the ice than positive tests, and nobody saw that coming.
Yeah, it's been 10 days, and there's been like 8 fights. It's unreal.
Absolutely. And, you know, that's good because that means guys are getting sick of each other, and they want to go out there and beat the you-know-what out of each other to try to win hockey games. But the one thing the NHL did, everybody was on the same page early. It could have been very easy to say, let's get back before the NBA, or let's get back for Major League Baseball. they said, for the first time probably in NHL history, the players and owners were on the same side in terms of, okay, what's going to be best for our league? And if Edmonton and Toronto is where we need to be, then so be it. The West over here and the East over there. But the best thing they've done, and this is something that Major League Baseball players have hopefully started to figure out, they were holding each other accountable. From what I heard and from what people told me, there are plenty of players behind the scenes saying, we didn't want this season to be a lost season. Don't screw up and undo what we all want, and that is being back on the ice. Yeah, we're not going to have fans, but that doesn't mean we cannot have action. We're going to have action on the ice. But don't be that guy that undoes everything that we're trying to do. Don't try to sneak in your girlfriend in like that Seahawks rookie. Don't try to go here and do like that, because then you're ruining it for everybody else. It's not just going to happen to you. The fact that they were on the same page and took their time and said, this is our plan. And everybody looked at that plan and said, that's a pretty damn good plan that the NHL has. And they made the plan even better to work out, not just for this season, but going forward. We may have a better and unified NHL that nobody saw coming, because people wondered, what could Gary Bettman do to bring this league back and bring this league together? We got to give him a lot of credit that he and his NHL put a plan in place. The players said, absolutely. There was no contention between the players and the owners. And look how we've been able to see that work with great hockey action all over the place. People still be talking about that 5-overtime game between the Columbus Blue Jackets in game one against the Tampa Bay Lightning. But then even you had the Capitals and the Islanders game yesterday. That was tremendous. Or you had the Blue Jackets down 3-0. They come all the way back and force that in the first round qualifier series. The action we knew was going to be good. It's better than anybody could have thought. And this could be something going forward that raises the love of the NHL, because they're all on the same page, getting their sport back on the ice when COVID-19 shut everything down.
Also, even like just not even the COVID plan, like how good it's gone. The NHL and NHL Players Association sat down and hammered out their collective bargaining agreement extension with no problems. We all know that the two lockouts have happened in the past. They had no issues. They're going to go back to the Olympics, which is what all the players want. Mm-hmm. I think hockey could be on the verge of a big boom here, especially with the Seattle team incoming in two seasons.
Especially when Seattle not only did their homework by getting a team back in the city, but they automatically have one of the top three logos in sports when it comes to the Kraken. The NHL
clearly has grown on me. Yeah.
It is so creative.
I'm a Rangers fan, but I'm buying a Kraken hat at a certain
point. Oh, absolutely. Come on now. Absolutely.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. And the NHL, it's always cool when a league understands the times and they join the 21st century. Major League Baseball can take a lot of lessons from the NHL, because it seems to me that Major League Baseball is hoping that Babe Ruth and Ty Cobb and Hank Aaron are going to walk through that door and save their sport. The NHL says, we're in the 21st century. We got a cool sport that would appeal to 21st century short attention span theater people. So why are we not doing that? And the minute they had more of a social media presence, and they had a big blowout, even during the pandemic, about here's our new team in Seattle. By the way, here's their logo. They didn't just hope that you were going to see it. They made a point that you were going to see it. And the same thing with their games. They're not waiting for people to come to them. They're letting people know, hey, we're on USA. We're over here. We're over there. Hey, if you miss Columbus in game one versus Tampa Bay, you better be here for game two. They've done a tremendous job saying we can be a 20th century sport and not lose the ideas that made the National Hockey League successful, but we can do it in a 21st century way. They have set a standard that plenty of other leagues probably looked at and won't give them credit, but saying, yeah, we follow that model. That model is going to be pretty good for our sports, because look how it's worked for the NHL.
Now, we talked about how good the NHL and the NBA really have been doing. I mean, and honestly, any team, any league that's done the bubble has had great success. And then you look at the MLB, who didn't do a bubble, and they're getting cases everywhere. Now, the MLB and the NFL is a different ball game. How do you literally. Think the NFL is – literally, exactly. How do you think the NFL is going to handle – or not the NHL, sorry, the NFL is going to handle COVID in general? I mean, they're talking about having fans in the arenas. I mean, how do you think – personally, Freddie, how do you think that's going to go overall?
I trust the owners when it comes to money in the NFL. When it comes to issues outside of money, I'm shaking my head. And I guarantee you there are plenty of players out there saying, yeah, we want to play. But I wonder how much the players are going to take things into their own hands and not trust the owners or Roger Goodell, the commissioner, that they're going to do that. And I don't blame them, because the owners know that everybody is not going to make any money this year. But the NFL stands as the one league that stands to have the most money that's not going to be missed because they have all this advertising. So that's still going to be there for them, whether they're fans in the stands or not. But if you're Jerry Jones, who put it out there that he's determined to have fans in the stands. But yet you have Washington saying, yeah, we can't do that week one. The Kansas City said, we can't do that the first couple of home games.
New Orleans came out today and said it, right?
Right, exactly.
Came out today and said that. The Raiders also said we'll have no home fans home games.
Yeah, they're not going to. So you have all these different fiefdoms in the National Football League that feel they're going to do best for their team. But if you're a player, more than ever before, you got to look out for yourself. And that's not to say that owners don't want to look out for players. They'll look out for players if it means that that's going to bring them a lot of money or not lose them any money from that standpoint. So the NFL so far, even without a bubble environment, they've done a really good job of making sure there's a maintain of safety. And if somebody goes beyond that, like that Seahawks rookie trying to sneak in his girlfriend, they cut him. They didn't give him another chance. They said, look, if you don't care about the safety of this team, bringing in somebody else, then you can't be part of the National Football League. We're not going to have you a part of our organization. So far, so good. I've always been a big believer when games start, then we'll find out, because now it involves travel. It involves personnel. How are you going to make sure that travel party is going to be safe when they get on the plane, when they land, and then when they leave? That is a big question that right now the NFL and college football does not have an answer to, because they have not had a chance to do that yet. You understand what the Big Ten and the Pac-12 decided to not do that when it comes to football in the season. But the NFL believes that they can do this successfully and safely. Well, we're going to see one way or the other if they're able to do that, especially when they're apparently going to start on time September 10th when the Texans play Kansas City to kick off the NFL season. That's right around the corner.
You brought up college.
It's not really a huge point, but a lot of people have been talking about, well, the XFL just got sold, the Rock for $10 million. And, you know, college football isn't doing fall seasons. Do you think there's any chance that if the XFL somehow got going, that some of these college players would try to play there in an attempt to stay game ready for the NFL season?
I don't think so, because the XFL does not have that kind of capital. Now, if they made them offer, they couldn't refuse, you'd be fooled to turn down that money. But there's still a safety issue in terms of insurance and liability with an upstart league. If anybody knows what kind of going to be, to stay in game shape, I'd rather do that trying to do that in an NFL camp, not having played fall football in college, than trying to do that and hope that's going to work in spring football with the XFL. And I also believe this country still does not want to embrace spring football. We have enough in fall football, whether it's high school, college, or the NFL. And if there's no star power in spring football, then what's the hook? Now, the XFL did a couple of things on the field with the kickoffs and the two-point conversions I thought were pretty cool. But that novelty effect lasted a couple of weeks, and after that, the attendance and the ratings died off, as you would think was going to happen with the XFL. So they have some good ideas, but unless you get a Johnny Manziel or a Tim Tebow to play that can hook people in to watch, and then you keep them if they're playing well, there's only so much of a novelty factor that's going to work for you. And everybody knows that. That's why it'd be really interesting to me, let's say if they have spring football in the Big Ten and the Mid-American Conference in the Pac-12, who's going to play? If I'm Justin Fields of Ohio State and I have a chance to be a top three pick, why am I going to play in spring football and risk injury and then not get drafted in the top three in the NFL? That wouldn't make any sense to me. So if you're a big-time star, you're going to say, you know, you want that freshman you got from Massillon, Ohio, then you better play him in spring football because I'm not going to do it. It has to work. You have to take care of yourself more than everything else. And that's not taking care of yourself. You think that we're not playing fall football, but I'm going to try my luck in the XFL just to stay in football shape.
Yeah, you brought up the college football aspect of it, and I think there's a two-sided coin here. I think there's a way for it to succeed, and then obviously there's the big question mark of how it, you know, fizzles out and it ends up going down the drain. The side of it being able to succeed, right, as you think about it, college campuses are usually going to have housing specific for athletes. You take the football players and you stick them all in dorms. You know, you have swipe access in and out, or, you know, there are certain times that the building locks. If you're out after a certain hour, you can't get in. But then you look at the other side of the coin is the whole, you know, the college aspect, you know, young kids, late teens, early 20s, it's, you know, they want to go out and have the full experience of college. Are you going to actually be able to keep these kids locked down and not go out to a party on a Saturday night following a big game over conference rival?
You know, that's the one thing I've always wondered about, because to your point, that's been, to me, the worst thing about the pandemic is taking away the social charter when it comes to people interacting. I saw a great tweet today where somebody said, it's been 5 months since I dapped my homies. And that told me everything I needed to hear about the lack of social interaction that has gone on. Now, other people have tried that social interaction and has not led to good results depending on where you are, who you're around, and what state that you live in. So that is something that college coaches who've done a really good job in the SEC, the ACC, the Big 12, because they can control that environment. But you're right. We have 18 to 22-year-olds who enjoy that social aspect. They don't want to have a social aspect on Zoom, talking to a girl, talking to their friends. They want to have that face-to-face contact, and then we'll see what's what, because that's what college is about when it comes to that social charter. So that is something that you're going to have to deal with. Not so much in the NFL, because I'm sure players look at that and say, man, I got too much money to risk, and do I want to get stink eye from my teammates because I could not control myself? But in college, one guy may be thinking of it, and 8 or 9 other guys probably thinking of the same thing. Are they going to get together? Are you going to take a temperature? Everybody you're going to be in contact with? Nobody has that kind of technology. So that is something that coaches have to be worried about, whether it's college football, whether it's college basketball, anybody playing a college sport, male or female. What is it like if they're, when they're not away from that bubble environment that you created to keep them safe and want to make sure you have a sport or a season one way or the other?
Well, Freddie, we can't thank you enough for your time here today. Where can people find you on social media? Where can they tune into the show? Let the people know.
You can always hit me on Twitter, Coleman ESPN, also on Instagram at Coleman Experience, and Freddie and Fitzsimmons, Monday through Friday, 9 p.m. to 1 a.m. Eastern time on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and SiriusXM Channel 80.
Well, love it.
Freddie, it was a great time chatting today. What before we let you go, give who do you got in the finals for both the NBA and the
Get
NHL?
Get some hot takes here.
Yeah.
I'd still trust the Clippers in the Western Conference in the NBA, and I like the Toronto Raptors in the East. I think both of those two will get involved in it. In the West, in the NHL, I like Tampa Bay, but I'm still worried about that team. How much residual is still there? So I don't trust them. I'm going to trust the Boston Bruins because Bergeron, we know what he does in the playoffs. We know that they're going to be able to find a way with their goaltending, and also they win those close games all the time. So
That's right.
I got Boston. I have to have Toronto coming out of the West, but the Columbus Blue Jackets ruined that whole scenario from that standpoint. That I wanted Toronto coming out of the East, but the Columbus Blue Jackets worried that.
Yep.
But in the West, I'll take the Sharks. I think the Sharks will do some things and get out of the West and get there somehow, some way. So I got the Sharks meeting
Sharks
up with Boston.
Sharks aren't in the playoffs. Sorry to break it to you, Freddie.
I'm sorry. Not the Sharks. I'm sorry.
The Knights?
Thank you. Not the Golden Knights. No, I'm not trusting them.
Nope.
No.
Oh, okay.
I'm not trusting the Golden Knights. I'm going to trust the Blues. I think the Blues get there.
Blues.
Oh, okay. Rematch.
Okay.
I think Blues and Bruins will get there. Yeah, I think the Blues will learn the lesson.
All right. Well, you heard it here first. Again, you can find Freddie on Twitter, on Instagram. Be sure to tune in. Catch the radio show 9 p.m. on ESPN Radio and ESPN Radio app. Freddie, it was a great time, man. We'll have to get you back on soon. And
absolutely.
Thanks again.
My pleasure, Ian, Cameron, and Connor, man. Really appreciate you guys. And let's do it again soon, my friends.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
We'll be back here on Titletown Takes right after this. All right. Once again, huge thanks to Freddie Coleman. Fellas, that was a great interview. A lot of good stuff out of that one. Any takeaways from it?
Guy puts the personality in radio personality.
Yeah,
he does. A beauty. Yeah. Loved it. Great dude. And just one of those few people that, you know, is on the top of his game and, you know, takes time out of his day to you know, one, come on our show, and then two, like, you know, give advice to us and stuff like that. So didn't have to do any of it. So stand-up guy, Freddie Coleman, cheers.
So
yeah, he did it. Yeah, we really appreciate, you know, he gave us some really good advice, and, you know, it's cool to get, you know, we have had a bunch of local people talk about what they did during the stoppages and stuff, but getting an actual guy from ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports, to talk about, hey, here's what we talked about when things were done, when things were going on. It's pretty freaking cool. And I just want to echo Connor's statement. We really appreciate him coming out.
Yeah, absolutely. That was a lot of fun. And shout out to him as well. Today's intro song was picked by him. So, So
it's what we try to do with our guests. Let them pick our intro songs.
Yeah, unless
our little appreciation, right?
Yeah, and I mean, who can fault them? I mean, Jimi Hendrix. I mean, come on.
Yeah, the picture in the background.
Exactly, and now, credit to me. I saw that and I was like, the way he was holding that guitar, I was like, yeah, that looks like it's got to be Hendrix. So.
And it was.
It was. So, but all right, fellas, you guys want to talk some football? We haven't talked football in forever.
Since the draft, realistically. When Cam Newton signed.
Yeah, but and still. But that's a perfect point to jump off at, because, fellas, from what I've seen on Twitter and what I've heard from, you know, another guest of the show, Bob Soucy, who's been chatting with the morning show and then the midday show on 98.5 The Sports Hub, Cam Newton looks freaking good right now. I mean, I know he's going up against his own guys, and I know there's probably not a whole lot of contact if there's any contact in these practices, but it's a promising sign for Patriots fans to see this guy who's coming off of multiple injuries in the last couple of years to hear how good that he looks so far through 2 weeks of training camp. Cam, we'll go to you first, since you're the man who called the shot.
I'm driving the Cam Newton hype train. I'm pumped. I'm very happy that he's performing well in training camp and, you know, slowly but surely coming along. It's not going to come all at one point. Not going to come all at one time with the injuries that he's had, but it's just nice to see that. Hopefully the Patriots quarterback position is at least taken care of for the short-term future. You know, I'm not so sure about Stidham. You guys know that. And I don't think they're going to bring in Newton just to sit on the bench.
No.
So I think it's his job to lose.
Cam Newton's the starting quarterback, and I said that the day that he signed here. I don't care what everybody else is saying. Oh, yeah, there's going to be, you know, there's going to be a competition. We'll go through this and that, blah, blah, blah. No. You're not going to freaking sign Cam Newton to have him sit on the sideline, hold the clipboard, and throw in signs. That's not going to happen.
It's also nice to see that I know the Patriots wide receiver depth has been lacking lately. And they see a guy like Gunnar Olszewski, Division II player out of Bemidji, or Division One FCS player out of, or Division II, whatever, out of Bemidji State.
Go Beavers!
Apparently he's balling out in practice. He made an Odell-style catch. He's been, you know, according to, I think Mark Girardi tweeted it, no corner wants to go against Olszewski. Three catches and counting to start practice. He tweeted that yesterday. And, you know, if we can get a new Edelman-Welker-type player, you know, ready to go, it could be paying huge dividends. Or the Patriots defense could just play like crap and he's, you know, not as good as we think. But I like to think it's the first option.
I've heard the defense has looked real good. So, I'm excited, man. Hearing all these things about the rookies and stuff, like Josh Trouche and who's the other guy?
Asiasi?
No, defense.
Oh,
we're so unprofessional.
Duggar?
Duggar, yes, but there's another guy, another linebacker. I've heard
Duggar's looked pretty good these last couple of weeks. He's had a couple of picks in practice. Now he's
Connor's. Hold on, I'm looking it up.
Connor's going to look it up. Winovich?
Nope.
Because I want to get to Winovich.
Was this the draft pick?
He's a draft pick this year. I guess it's probably easy to just look at the Patriots draft picks this year. Patriots draft picks. I'm going to cut this part out. Anfernee Jennings. Yes, that's who I was thinking of.
Just call him Penny, like Penny Hardaway.
Him and Uche have looked real good, I've heard, on top of Kyle Duggar. So defense, you know, got a little revamp. You know, you don't have Hightower this year, so you're going to need those guys to step up. You don't have Patrick Chung, so you need a guy like Kyle Duggar to step up too. So hopefully they can keep it going when they're thrown into the fire come the NFL regular season, which is also only a week or two away here now, boys.
I've also heard that Damian Harris, Alabama running back. I heard he's looked very good in training camp as well. So all encouraging, especially after our running game was very suspect last year.
Yep, with Sony Michaels coming back yesterday, I believe, was his first day of training camp. So
Sony Michaels.
And, yes, we know it's Sony Michel.
And Boosh.
Oh, Lord.
What a character.
Another star or another eye to keep, you know, another guy to keep an eye on here defensively is Chase Winovich. Second year man out of Michigan. He confirmed. Confirmed. Big milk guy.
Likes milk?
Big milk guy. So
remind you of anybody?
Oh, dude, I love milk. I think me and Winnow would get along great.
I've heard he's an absolute, like, bro.
I mean, looking at his hair, I can see that. But going back to July 27th, 11:43 a.m., tweeted out, great day to drink milk. July 28th, 10:07 p.m., pouring a glass of milk out for the boys who can't be with us out on the field this year. And he tweeted out an emoji with a glass of milk and someone going like this with their hand and a heart next to it. So
that's good.
Confirmed big guy. And it carried over early on to this week when he was asked about his love for milk during a Zoom video conference this week. He goes, I feel like there's a subtle war against milk. I obviously enjoy milk. I think dairy farmers do excellent work around this country. We need to appreciate them and the beautiful cows that are also milked and produce this delicious milk.
Well, he's a Midwestern boy, so
yeah. What I will say is, like, actual milk from, like, straight from a farm is delicious. It's so much better than the milk you'll buy at, like, the supermarket. That I will say.
I'm a big milk guy as well. So.
I don't really drink milk outside of, like, cereal.
Huge milk
but,
guy here.
Like we have this farm we get fresh milk from near us, and it changes the ball game, I'll tell you. So with the dairy farmers, I do agree with that aspect. You got to support local boys. You got to support your farms too.
Winovich is from Jefferson Hills, Pennsylvania. So I'm going to guess that there's probably not a whole lot going on in Jefferson Hills, PA.
Yep.
So maybe there's a lot of dairy farming going on out there. Winovich went on to say later on in his press conference, he says, I have a YouTube channel called, quote, and we'll give it a plug, Winnow on a Quest. He said, we actually went to Vermont, a place called Liberty Hill Farms. There's an Airbnb there. He says, I'm not sure how it operates with COVID and stuff, but I got the opportunity to meet all the cows and actually milk some. It's a super dramatic story. It was an awesome time. I really just
What a man.
Yeah. Said it was an awesome time. I really just fell in love with the process. Already had a love for milk. I've been tweeting about milk for years. I think I tweeted nothing like feeling like the feeling of milk running through your mustache a couple of years ago. As well as that, my cousin also is a dairy farmer in the Pittsburgh region in Lancaster County, Amish country. So I know that's a lot of an answer. But, yeah, that kind of gives us an inside look at Winovich and his love for milk. Oh, here's another tweet, fellas, from July 24th at 9:36. Almond milk isn't actually milk.
What in the fuck is almond milk? It's milk. Show me the tit on an almond.
So,
yeah.
No, it's not. So there's his stance on almond milk.
Man, Got Milk missed their big sponsor or big endorsement by 10 years. Is Got Milk even a thing anymore?
Dude, Hood is a New England based thing. I think Hood and Chase Winovich need to link up for a sponsorship connection.
No, I just mean like the big overarching Got Milk.
Oh yeah, with him, him with the mustache. Yeah, that's true.
I mean, you haven't seen one of those ads in ages.
In ages, yeah.
But, yeah, I thought it was really, really funny just to listen to that. You know, he said he finished up his press conference saying, There's a lot of knowledge here and a lot of leadership with this team across the board. A lot of guys love football and drinking milk.
There we go.
So this is great. I might have to order a Winovich jersey just for this reason alone.
And okay, what's his number, 50?
Yeah, and instead
50
of
50 with milk on the back.
I was going to put Milkman.
Yeah, that's good.
You know, that might have to be my my investment, because I was even thinking about getting a Cam Newton jersey, but if he's only really potentially going to be here for a year, I don't know if I'd rather – if I want to make
that
investment. I'd get
the Milkman jersey, Hundo P.
So that might have to be a thing here, fellas. I might have to make that purchase before week one kicks off.
And then tweet it at him.
Hell yeah.
Get him on the pod.
Oh, fellas, that may have to be a thing, but I think you'd have to go through Patriots PR for that one.
Well, but whatever we got
to
do.
Who knows? You know, maybe we tweet it to him and say, hey, you know, Milkman supporting another Milkman.
That's right.
But so. All right, fellas, we brought up week one kicking off, and we are 15 days when this drops here on Friday. 15 days away. Wait, no. 31 days in August. Sorry, I can't do math. Still not a math guy. So it will be 16 days on Friday from week one kickoff.
Casper's dog events.
So you want to do a little schedule breakdown here? Go ahead, Cam.
Just a little thing. Saturday, we've got the Battle of the Century, college football, ESPN. We've got Austin Peay taking on Central Arkansas.
Football?
Can I gamble on it?
Wow.
Probably.
Yeah, probably.
Oh, fellas.
Is that D1?
No.
I think that's FCS.
It might be 1AA.
Yeah, I would think.
Might be 1AA.
That's crazy. That's crazy. So, you know, we're already kicking off football.
Or what's left of college football, considering they're going to want to do spring ball.
Well, fellas, did you hear today?
FCS.
I don't know if
that's what they are. FCS.
I don't know if you heard.
Saturday
eight
at 9.
Eight guys from Nebraska are suing the Big Ten for the cancellation of their football season.
Really?
Yeah, good luck with that.
Yeah, they're not going to win that. They have like a million lawyers.
Well, this is also after last week where parents from players across the Big Ten met at Big Ten headquarters to protest.
For what?
And demand that they allow their kids to play.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, yeah.
Come on.
Hey, I can't fault them for wanting –
not a mask was probably worn in that protest. Not a single one, I bet.
I can't fault them for wanting to play, but I don't know if there's a logical way to do it. And these schools are not going to want to get sued for kids dying.
We saw what happened to Alabama. Alabama was on campus for what, a day?
A day, and they had 500 cases. That was,
they have more cases than Canada.
All of Canada.
I put in the group chat that they had more cases than the entirety of Canada in one day. Like the entirety of Canada in one day had less cases than the University of Alabama.
That's a joke. You like, and you expect these kids to play football?
Yeah.
Get out of here.
Eastern Kentucky University. I saw a thing yesterday. I think it was ECU, EKU, whatever it is. They had a massive
WKU.
Party.
It's,
whatever yeah. it was. I don't care.
No, like, this is what you have to understand.
People are dumb.
People are dumb. College kids are rebellious. And they're just not going to not party.
As a former college kid, I can say college kids are stupid.
Yeah. So, it's – I don't know. It's – that's like people who put in all these faith into college kids. You have to understand who you're talking about here. And trust me, we've been idiot college kids in our day too. But that's because we now understand that, you know, college kids are dumb. Because it's – you know, that's the point of your life you're in. So it's, you know, we'll see. We'll see how things go. I am certainly on the belief train that, you know, a couple months here in college just across the board could be all online again.
Mm-hmm. All right, fellas, you want to, we're already talking some football, but you want to break down the Patriots schedule?
Sure. Let's do it.
Let's see how bad Cam thinks that this football team is going to be.
I'll break it down into wins and losses.
Right, I'm getting the schedule up, yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll start us off here. I already got it pulled up. Patriots will kick off week one, September 13th at home against Miami. That'll be a 1 o'clock kickoff. They will then follow that up a week later on Sunday night out in Seattle, week two. Week three, they return home to take on the Las Vegas Raiders. That'll be a 1 o'clock kickoff at Gillette, followed by a trip to Kansas City. Again, no fans during this, potentially. So you're looking at avoiding a trip to Seattle and Kansas City without fans.
That's good.
So that may as well essentially be a neutral site game, aside from, you know, having to travel and being in a visiting team locker room there. But with no fans, it's going to be a completely different experience. The Patriots will take on Denver in week five, October 11th, 1 o'clock kickoff, followed by a bye week. And then they will return to action on the 25th of October at home, 4:25 kickoff against the San Francisco 49ers. Jimmy G will be coming to New England. This will be his first trip back to New England, yep. Correct?
Yeah.
Okay. I thought so. That'll be followed up by two road division games. They will play November 1st at Buffalo, 1 o'clock, followed by a Monday night game against the New York Jets. That'll be an 8:15 kickoff on ESPN. Week 10, they will have another Sunday night game, so you have back-to-back weeks of primetime games. This will be against the Baltimore Ravens in Foxborough, 8:20 kickoff on NBC for that one. They will then head to Houston the following week for a 1 o'clock kickoff against the Texans in Week 11. Week 12, the Arizona Cardinals will come to town on the 29th of November, 1 o'clock kickoff there, followed by a doubleheader at the brand spanking new SoFi Stadium out in Los Angeles, a Sunday afternoon game against the Chargers, followed by a Thursday night game against the Los Angeles Rams. That'll be an 8:20 kickoff there. They will then return to the East Coast for a Sunday night game on December 20th down in Miami for a 1 o'clock game. And we can finally no longer hear the narrative of Tom Brady plays terribly in Miami. So that'll finally get shipped out the window. And they will then wrap up with home games, a Monday night game against the Bills 3 days after Christmas, followed by a Week 17 matchup on January 3rd against the New York Jets at 1 o'clock. Fellas, with that in mind, let's get into it a little bit deeper here and take a look and see what we got for wins and losses. Who wants to go first?
Wickes, you want to take it, buddy?
I guess.
I mean, you don't have to go first. You can put Connor on the spot, or I can go first.
I'll go. The Patriots will beat the Dolphins week one. They're going to lose to the Seahawks week two. They're going to beat the Raiders week three, lose to the Chiefs, beat the Broncos, lose to the Niners, beat the Bills, beat the Jets, lose to the Ravens, lose to the Texans, I think. Beat the Cardinals, beat the Chargers, lose to the Rams, beat the Dolphins, lose to the Bills, and beat the Jets.
So you have them losing to the Bills twice?
Yes.
So you have the Bills winning the division?
Yes.
Wow. Interesting take.
Okay.
So what's your record? Have you calculated that? I can go and then
10-6?
I think that was about 10-6, yeah. Let me count my losses. So two Bills.
Seattle, Kansas two Bills, City.
Yep.
Baltimore and Houston.
Mm-hmm. All right. I have them beating Miami, losing to Seattle, beating the Raiders, losing to the Chiefs, beating the Broncos, losing to San Fran, beating the Bills, beating the Jets, losing to the Ravens, beating the Texans, beating the Cardinals, beating both LA teams. I think they're going to lose that Miami game, and then they're going to beat the Jets. 2, 4, 6, 8. 11-5.
11-5. All right. So I have wins at against Miami, at Seattle, at home against Vegas. They'll lose to Kansas City. They'll beat Denver. That San Fran game is a toss-up.
I think there's a couple toss-ups on there, to be honest with you.
The only reason why I consider it a toss-up is because you're at home. Again, yeah. We know there's no fans, but I think just the benefit of having San Fran come here gives you a little bit of a better chance. But for this sake, I'll put the San Fran game in the loss category. So through week 7, I have them at 4-2. They'll lose in Buffalo. So 4-3. They'll beat the Jets, lose to the Ravens, and then they will rattle off four straight wins against the Texans, Cardinals, Chargers, and Rams. Lose to the Dolphins in Miami and then beat the Bills and Jets at home. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 12-4.
12-4?
12-4.
I think best case 11-5, worst case like 9-7. If I could genuinely see either of those.
And records. I mean, I put the Buffalo game as a loss on there. But I mean, who knows?
It's like all those games are a toss-up, right?
It's the Bills. Let's be honest here. Yeah, they were good last year, but who knows what they're going to be this year.
Here's what people need to understand. Tom Brady's gone. Yeah, sure. Gronk's with him. Tampa Bay, whatever. We still got Bill Belichick, baby. The best coach of all time. He's going to get his players prepared to be out there. Good game plan. So I think this team's not going to be as bad as people think they're going to be. Cam Newton helps a lot, though. I mean, let's be honest. You know, Jared Stidham, God bless his arm.
Not according to Pete.
Well, you know, hot take hotline over there, Cohen.
But, fellas, we've already mentioned it, but, you know, what do you think it's going to be like for these guys with no fans in stadiums? What do you think the product is going to look like on TV?
It'll be the same. I don't think there's going to be much different, to be honest with you. I think there's going to be more camera. It's going to be a lot like the NHL and the NBA. I mean, it's going to be different, obviously, because there's no fans, and that's just, you know, a lot different. And these guys have played, a lot of them, like big-time college football where there's tons of fans right on top of you and used to that experience. But I don't think, you know, I don't – after watching how the NFL and the NBA and even the MLB and all the, you know, the NWSL and other sports leagues that have played have looked, I mean, you just get used to it, right? It's just – guys are just going to – I mean, it's going to be – you know, the NHL players compared it more to like a Winter Classic type vibes where it's more of an experience on the ice instead of more of like a playoff atmosphere and stuff like that. So I don't anticipate too many changes from the product, to be honest.
I personally think the NFL has a chance to put the best product
big time
out there.
They just had the most money,
out of the
too.
Four major groups, and that's why. It's just solely based on money.
Space too. They have a lot of space.
Yeah.
With these monstrous stadiums.
Cam, your thoughts on potentially no fans there? I mean, again, that's my whole reasoning for giving the Patriots the win in Seattle. You take away all those maniacs in
the 12th man.
In Seattle, you take away the 12th man. It's essentially a neutral site game in Seattle and Kansas City. I think Kansas City's just that much of a better football team right now.
I think Seattle's better than the Patriots. So,
me too.
That's why I took them. I don't mean fans, no fans. It's not a big deal. I mean, if a team's better than you, they're going to beat you.
I think matchups are going to be a lot more important now.
Yeah.
You know, that's why I think the Patriots are in good shape. Bill Belichick's a mastermind, and the stuff like that's going to be so much more apparent now.
It's just, I don't know. Everyone's going to be on the equal playing field. It'll come down to skill, and I think the Seahawks are a better team in that situation. Same thing with the Chiefs.
Oh, yeah, Chiefs are absolutely a much better football team than the Patriots. It's not even a question. Especially, I mean, you look at the depth that they have on offense. I mean, holy crap.
Yeah.
Their weapons just keep flowing out of the locker room left and right.
Mm-hmm.
So, it is what it is. But I am interested to see what it's going to look like. I mean, and I kind of agree with you, Connor. I think it'll be similar to what we see with the NBA and the NHL and the other professional sports leagues that have come out and set up environments for these games to accommodate the fact that there's no fans, to make it appealing on viewers sitting at home watching. You know, they don't want to look at the empty seats. Hence why at Scotiabank and in Rogers Place, you see the tarps over the seats. And it gives it more of that video game style feel that you see when you play NHL. I think we're going to see something similar to that.
Lightning definitely had it on Rookie last night.
Yeah.
It's a good transition.
We'll get to that in a second. But there is also the question of whether or not Fox and or CBS is going to do the CGI fans in the stands to make it look like for wider shots.
Hated that, to be honest, boys.
It just looked bad.
Yeah,
like, you're at home, and we know that these seats are all empty. There's no need. Yeah, there's no need to sit there and put computer animated people in seats.
Good in theory, not good in practice.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, yeah. I get that you're trying to make it more appealing to the viewer at home, but again, the viewer at home knows that those stadiums are empty aside from the players, team staff, and building or stadium people that need to be there. That's it. There's no fooling
us. I'm big on the tarps and screens. I think it looks good what the NBA and NHL are doing. Yeah. Yeah, I think it looks good. It's way better than the cardboard cutouts and virtual fans that the MLB is doing.
The other thing too that the NFL is looking
into. I like the cardboard cutouts.
The other thing, too, that they're looking into is ambient noise being pumped into the stadiums. I mean, if that's the case, the Atlanta Falcons should already have a pretty good system set up and ready to rock
and the Colts
down there. And the Colts as well. So, you know, you can expect good game productions out of those crews in Indianapolis and Atlanta. You know, they've had a couple of trial runs back when it was illegal to do so in the NFL.
So, it's a good point.
But I can't wait to see how long it's going to take before a coach complains about how the sound system's set up at Gillette. And, you know, well, they complain, oh, well, why is the visitor's sideline volume cranked up to, you know, say 11 on the dial, and on the Patriots sideline it's only set at a 7 or an 8? You know, I can't wait for that to come out and say from a coach, a visiting coach.
Yep.
Luckily, the Steelers don't come to town, because you know Mike Tomlin would find a way to bitch and complain about that.
Yeah, he would.
I still find it hysterical how he went out and, you know, was complaining that supposedly a couple of years ago in a playoff game that all of a sudden over their headsets they were hearing Bob and Zoe over the radio on the broadcast in their headsets. So whether or not that was actually true has yet to be revealed. I mean, only people on the Steelers staff can confirm or deny that, but that is a good sign for the Patriots that the Steelers don't come to town, because you know that there would be a complaint the Monday, the day after the game, whether they played on a Sunday or Monday, whatever. So, but all right, let's move along. We've made Cam wait long enough for this. For people that have been following along, you know, we've been doing pre and post game recaps. We did pregame last night, but on Wednesday night we did pregame. There was no postgame. There was no need. Again, we tweeted out in the middle of the second period last night, and these were Cam's words specifically. to a point, I kind of tinkered with a little bit, make it a little more humorous and make it a little more easy on the eyes. It says, as the Bruins failed to show up tonight, we will as well wipe the slate clean and focus on game four. With that said, it's not officially a Cam's Corner, but Karen, the floor is all yours. And I'm just going to sit back. And, if you feel the need to let the expletives fly, again, we have it
marked. They don't even deserve that.
We can't have this marked as explicit content for our podcast listeners. So if you do feel the need to let them fly, it's acceptable. So without further ado, here is Cameron's rant following the Bruins 7-1 shellacking at the hands of the Tampa Bay Lightning. Cameron, the floor is all yours. Cam, we can't hear you, bud.
How about now?
Okay, yeah, there we go.
All right, my headphones had a soft disconnect. That's my fault. But as everybody knows, or should maybe know, in January of this season, the Bruins played a game in Vancouver. And in said game, they played a terrible game and lost 9-2. Now, this is relevant because last night's game technically was not the worst loss the Bruins have had this season. It also should be noted that I sat through that 9-2 game start to finish, from the opening drop of the puck to the final siren. Sat through that horrible, repugnant 9-2 game. They could not pay me to watch the third period of last night's Bruins game. The lack of effort there was appalling. The only one out there who cared was Marchand. Marchand was the only one. In all three games, Marchand's been the only one who cares. Torrey Krug needs to sit, or I'd say even just trade him now. Just say, hey, get started on your free agency now. Just hitting Tyler Johnson in the face because he won the puck off you. Fighting Sorelli. I don't know who it was. Pinch. Not only did he fight Sorelli or whoever Ms. it was. Johnson. I don't even care. Johnson, whatever.
That was the face. Hold on. That was warranted, though.
No.
That
it was not.
Not that. The scrap.
No, it wasn't. You want to know why? Because Krug's pinching down in the corner, starting crap with Tyler Johnson. McAvoy is in another time zone. And you're going to let friggin' Braden Point get a breakaway on your newly debuted, 4 minutes into his NHL career, goaltender Dan Vladar. That is appalling. That is BS. You cannot let that happen. Torrey Krug is – I put this in a chat yesterday. I put it in multiple chats. Torrey Krug is going to get paid $8 million to not play defense and not hit the net on his shots. And I damn sure hope it ain't us. I damn sure hope it ain't us. The guy is a pathetic waste of defensive talent, pathetic waste of talent, didn't care, doesn't care, hasn't cared. I don't care how good he looked in the Carolina series. That series is done. That series is over. It's time to move on and play a team that I've said has been much better than you. Much better than you. In every facet of the game. Every facet, they are better than you. They put the puck in the net more than you. They have a better friggin' defense than – wait, maybe not better defense. I'll give them that. The Bruins, I think, have better defense. But they are better offensively. They have a better bottom six than you. They have a better top six than you. Like – show some heart, for God's sakes. 7-1? 7-1? The first period, I'll admit, we got a little screwed. Bad call on Wagner. Linesman got in the way. They scored on both of them. So that's 20 minutes you can put maybe by the wayside. But the last 40 minutes, three guys standing at the blue line while letting the Lightning break out and move the puck out of the zone? Why? What are you doing? I don't understand. And Bruce Cassidy, I picked the bone with him to start the playoffs. I'm going to get back on Bruce Cassidy. Bruce Cassidy sat Corrali and played Lauzon and sat Clifton to play John friggin' Moore. He saw, the Lightning played seven defensemen. Let me follow. The first rule of hockey, never play your opponent's game. The Bruins were baited into playing their opponent's game, and they paid for it. Listen, Clifton is not the greatest defenseman in the world. Yeah, Dad, what's up? All right. You can keep this in. No, it's all right.
Oh, this is great. Shout out to Mr. Urbowicz.
Oh my God.
Connor, what say you? What do you have any thoughts?
What say I mean, I can finish Cam's thought for him.
No, I've got it.
Yeah.
I've got it. So the first rule of hockey is never play your opponent's game. Cassidy was baited into doing that, and it's clear he's out coached. He doesn't know what he's doing. He is out coached. His team was outplayed. He didn't make any adjustments. And then the Bruins sat there and didn't even take their beating. Krug shooting a puck at a linesman. Nordstrom trying to kill somebody.
All right. Krug didn't actually – he just shot that to the other side of the ice, and it happened to hit the linesman in the skate. I don't see it. Hey, that's Mr. Urbowicz, how we doing?
How you get – you know what that is, Ian? That's how you get extra penalties called on you. That's what that is.
Okay. All right, hold on. I need a minute now, okay? I need a minute now.
Let's go.
Because as much as you want to sit here and complain about how the Bruins were baited into playing Tampa style last night, and as bad as the Bruins played last night, the officiating last night and the night before were a fucking joke.
Yeah, but the officiating didn't give up 7 goals.
No, but giving Tampa Bay 8 power play opportunities, it's like the officiating last night was trying to give Tampa Bay a kick in the ass for their power play. It's like they knew Tampa was 0-14 going into the power play going into last night. Okay, I just hope the NHL didn't allow Tampa's power play to wake up from the hibernation that they were in for the last 3 weeks. Okay, you absolutely a joke. Okay, there is no reason for the Bruins to get called for roughing penalties night after night, period after period, when Tampa Bay is doing the same shit in front of the Boston goal that the Bruins are doing in front of the Tampa Bay goaltender in Vasilevsky. Okay, something has to change, and something has to change right freaking now.
I'm just saying.
It's also valid.
I'm going to say it here, and you guys can agree or disagree. I don't see the Bruins winning another game this series.
Disagree.
Absolutely
strong,
no way.
Strong disagree.
No way. I'm not even going to wear my Bruins gear for game 4 whenever it takes place. They don't. They haven't
Bruins,
earned it.
Your Bruins fan privileges have once a bit. Once
no,
again,
they have not been revoked.
They have been revoked.
Why, Ian, you want to know why they haven't been revoked? They haven't given me a reason to root for them. I sat there and I watched that repugnant effort for 40 minutes and I said, I'm tapping out. I'm done. If they want me to root for them, they have to care. They do not care.
Again,
it is obvious they do not care.
Again, getting sandbagged by
Cassidy
the officials.
If Cassidy continues this, listen, 2018 was a long time ago. The Bruins then and the Bruins now and the Lightning then and the Lightning now are two completely different entities. But if Cassidy comes out and loses 8 of 10 in the playoffs against the Lightning, he needs to go. And they need to find someone
here we go.
Who can motivate
here we
the
go.
Team to figure out how
firing
to beat
up
the
good
team. Firing
up the fireproof truck.
The Bruins went to the Stanley Cup last season on the fact that they had to play none of the teams that they had trouble with. They didn't have to play the Caps. They didn't have to play the Lightning. They
okay,
got to play the.
And that's Cassidy's
they got to play
fault?
The Cinder. It is not Cassidy's fault.
Okay.
But when you get
then
these
take
golden
the keys
opportunities,
out of the fire,
when you get these golden opportunities to win a championship, you have to take them. The Bruins had the Stanley Cup in their hands going against the Blues in game 1, and they failed to show up in any sense, way, or form in any of the 7 games in which the Bruins played. The top line had 0, count them 0, 5-on-5 points against the Blues last season. Last in the Stanley Cup final, 0. The second line was the best line they played. Then it was followed by the fourth line. You can talk about the Bruins getting screwed and the friggin' trip on Achari that wasn't called, but the fact of the matter is, when it came down to it, the Blues players showed up and the Bruins did not. And it's clear right now that the Bruins are not showing up. They don't care. They need to show that they care. And if they don't start playing like we all know they can play, they are going to go home, and this will be one of the biggest abject failures in Bruins history. Boom.
I'm done. Yes, Cameron. That,
this,
yes.
This very well may have been the best heated exchange we have ever had here on the history
of
Titletown
Takes. I'm sick of the excuses. What's the, right. If they lose this year, what's the spin going to be? That Rask didn't show up, that Rask went home? Sure. You got to be able to come back. You got to be able to play through that, man. Got to be able to play through that.
Okay.
All right. Can I go?
Hold on.
Can I have my turn? Or,
okay. One split second here.
Yep.
Hell, put Vladar in game four. He can't do much worse.
Cam, take the keys out of the Fire Bruce truck because it's not going anywhere.
I know he's not going to get fired.
You're not going to turn around, and you're not going to fire your head coach that's been here for 2.5 years, especially after a performance like last night, when the night before you had zero business probably getting that game to overtime.
But they tried in game four. They played bad, but they were still trying.
You mean game two?
They didn't try. Sorry.
You mean game two? The Bruins showed balls. In game two, they had no business getting that game to overtime the way that third period had kind of shaken out. Okay, the fact that Marchand was able to pot that goal late in the third period to put that game into overtime shows the balls. Okay, so for you,
he's the only one that cares.
Yeah, what happened to him though?
What do you mean? What happened to him?
They lost.
Happened to their balls? They were nowhere to be found.
Okay, great. Tampa came out hot at the start of the overtime. What are you going to do? The Bruins had the momentum.
No, not even in the overtime. I'm talking yesterday.
It was the back half. It was the back half of a back to back. Okay, I'm not going to put it.
Both teams played in a back to back, Ian.
Okay, great. But who won the night before? Tampa. Who's going to have all the momentum going into game three? Tampa. Okay, again, the officiating last night didn't help out the Bruins. The calls went against them early. You had a freaking linesman sitting a pick that allowed a clear breakaway opportunity that put Tampa up 2-0, and that deflated the bubble that the Bruins could have had. If that doesn't happen, it could very well still be a 1-0 game going into the end of the first period, or 1-1 game going into the end of the first period. Who knows what happens if the Bruins don't fall behind 2-0, okay? So I'm not going to sit here and completely say that the Bruins, are done, because they're not. They caught a 24-hour span of bad luck, all right? Relax here. I mean, it's 2020. They were the President's Trophy winners, and then shit hit the fan. The world came to a freaking halt. Nobody could go outside. People still can't go outside in large groups. Nobody wants to wear their masks, okay? 2020 needs to be sent into a freaking rocket and launched through a black hole into another galaxy, okay?
Let them know, Beauchesne. Let them know.
Okay? I'm not going to sit here and say that the Bruins have no heart. I'm frustrated with their performance last night. I was frustrated with how they ended game two, but I'm not going to give up on this team. I know that they can still come out and perform. The fact that they're not going to be playing game four on Friday night is huge. It allows them to sit there and eat the shit sandwich, as Justin Williams deemed last year after the Bruins kicked the shit out of Carolina in game two at home in Boston. Okay. This team is better. I know they're better. They have enough leadership between Chara. He's slow. Great. He's been around forever. Bergeron, the guy will play through a punctured lung with cracked ribs, a separated shoulder. Pasternak needs to learn how to play through that. He needs to take some of what Bergeron's gone through in the last 10 years and grow something down below and play through some of this when it comes to the playoffs. Halak needs to be better. Okay, putting the kid in last night didn't help, but at the same time, Cassidy realized they were on the back half of a back-to-back. He needs rest. Getting these couple extra days now is going to be huge. It could be huge. Tampa's mojo that they had coming off of game two and coming off of game three is null and void. Okay? There is no way that the momentum that Tampa had following game three is going to carry over into Saturday or Sunday. I don't see it happening. The Bruins win game four and we go into game five looking at a best of three series, and it is anyone's series after that. The Bruins win game four. Lock it in.
Show a lot of confidence. I don't believe it.
Connor,
I don't
go ahead. So. Someone on this damn show has to.
Oh, also, it's my turn.
Connor, can I share something before you
talk? Sure, go ahead.
So someone was I was in a chat yesterday, and stuff wasn't going good. Someone was like, oh, did the Bruins have a white flag they can wave? And I said, yeah, they put him in net.
Oh.
And I like Vladar, but that's the truth.
All right.
Good luck following up all this shit.
Ready for level heads here, Titletown Takes fans? We need some level-headed talk here, and I think I can bring it to you. All right. We're going to call it down the middle, okay? I'm a Bruins fan through and through. But call a spade a spade. I'm a guy who just, you know, calls it how I see it, no matter what it is. The Boston Bruins last night maybe played the worst game I've ever seen them play in my days as a Bruins fan. We've seen some dog days. You know, 2016, 2015, some bad Bruins games that we've seen. But last night was the worst I've seen. Call it what it is. From top to bottom, from head coach to backup goaltender, nothing was good about last night. Absolutely nothing. Do either of you disagree with that?
No.
Okay, good. First time we've been on the same page since we've talked about the Bruins. That's good. Good to hear. So, I am with Cam to a degree here. I think what Bruce Cassidy did with the lineup and the decisions he made in the game was just piss poor for Boston, piss poor for the Bruins. You have a track record recently in the playoffs of playing seven defensemen, and it has been known to not work whatsoever. I don't know what it is with this Bruins team, but when you play seven defensemen, it just isn't going to work, especially when you're playing your seventh defenseman as John Moore, okay? Not going to work. And I said yesterday, I was venting to Ian after the game was over. He's getting in his own head. He's listening to all the media members and what he should be doing, and he's doing what they're telling him to do. You need to play your hockey. Don't play Tampa's hockey. Don't play their lineup because it worked. Play your best lineup. Play your best players. I don't care that Tampa is big and physical and, you know, has some skill to them too. So we need to play our bigger lineup. Screw that, man. Just, like, screw that. Jack Studnicka has arguably been one of the best Bruins and most consistent Bruins forwards this entire playoff run. And he's been on the ninth floor the past couple games or wherever the hell they sit now in the bubble. Nick Ritchie is worthless. I was hand up was wrong about that. He had an impact in the regular season.
Looks like he hasn't skated in 3 years.
He's been so bad. He does nothing. He's big, and he doesn't play physical. He's not fast. He's just a waste of space next to Charlie Coyle, and he's sewering that line. He needs to go. Studnicka needs to come back in. If you're not, it's not working. Whatever you're doing, you play your big physical lineup the past three games, it hasn't worked. You need to change it. Playing big and playing physical against this team is not going to work. They're better than you in those areas. Try something else. Try to be faster. Try to be more skilled. Put more skill guys out there. Maybe it'll work. They're beating you up. They're beating you up. So why not put the better players out there who are just straight up better at hockey? Am I insane thinking that?
No.
Thank you.
That's what we did in game one, and we beat him.
Right. I don't care that Nick Ritchie's 6'3", 250 pounds. If he's playing poor, he needs to get off the ice. Sean Corrali may have an injury. Hasn't played great. I think him sitting out for all this extra time is going to be good. He's one of your best forwards when he's on his game. He's fast. He's strong. He's physical. He's not the biggest guy in the world, but he does the right things. Jack Studnicka needs to get back in the lineup. You know, The first line, I mean, like you said, Cam, Marchand's been the only one who's shown some heart. The defense needs to figure themselves out. And Jeremy Lauzon looked like a traffic cone. John Moore looked like a traffic cone. I've seen all I need to see from those guys. What worked? Connor Clifton played well. I don't know why they took him out of the lineup. So you go back to the drawing board in your defense. You work on your breakout. You work on your puck possession with those guys. And your best defensemen aren't playing good. McAvoy's really been the only guy of worth. And he's had some bad stretches in there too. So, Carlos sucked. Krug sucked.
Grizzlick
hasn't been necessarily good. I don't know what needs to happen, but Bruce Cassidy is the root of it, especially last game. And I'm not ready to jump ship yet like you, Cam. And I'm not particularly ready to say –
I don't
want to
fire
him.
He just needs to do better.
I just I'm not necessarily as positive as Ian's going to be that if we win game four, we're just going to win the series. I need to see – I was confident in this Bruins team going into this game. If you listen to the pregame show, I was very confident in this Bruins team going into this game. I don't know why. I just felt good. I thought this team, would bounce back from the overtime
loss. So much for a 2-1 win, eh?
Yeah. I mean, I felt good about the team. And you know what, Cam? You to go off your heart point and them not showing heart at all in this past game, I think it's bang on. And it's, the first period was what it was, okay? But when your backup goaltender, who's a rookie, comes in and you play questionably like five times worse in front of him in a playoff game, what are you doing? Like, what sense to, like, play with some pride? Like, play well, not for yourself, but for the 23-year-old kid who's never played an NHL game before.
Just you turned know 23.
It's going to be tough for him. Play well in front of him. And they played questionably worse. So, there's so much they need to work on. And it's not just the players. It's Cassidy needs to look at himself in the mirror and say, okay, we're the Boston Bruins. We're not the Tampa Bay Lightning. You're not going to beat the Tampa Bay Lightning playing Tampa Bay Lightning hockey. You're going to beat Tampa Bay Lightning playing Boston Bruins hockey. And I'll leave it at that.
For the record, I never said the Bruins win game four, they win the series. I said the Bruins will win game four, and then we have a best of three to see who wins the series.
Okay. Well, I heard you wrong, man.
Clean out your ears there, Powell.
Well, yeah, all right. Let's relax here. Let's level heads prevail.
So
I don't want to be right. I'll leave it at that. I don't want to be right.
Well, you never do, Cam, right? Like, you have these takes all the time with the Bruins, and yeah, it sucks when you're wrong and we're always making fun of you. But you don't want to be right.
I don't want to be right.
Cam, I hope you of all people – yeah – are more than willing to get the biggest suck it Cam ever.
Oh, of course I'm ready for that.
Okay.
Cam eats his crow whenever he's
on. I know, but he does. He's good about that. He's good about that. 100% I agree.
I mean, man.
Yeah, but I've said all year that I don't think this team is good enough. And game three, clearly not good enough. And something's got to change.
So, fellas, last night was the worst playoff loss for the Bruins since 1992 in the Adams Division semifinals when they fell to the Buffalo Sabres 9-3. They ended up going – that was in game six. They ended up going on to win game seven 3-2 and move on to the conference finals. So I guess if there's anything to take away – maybe history repeats itself. You get shellacked and get your brains kicked in by six. You turn things around and you right the ship the next game. Again, I think we all agree here that we want to see that happen. And I'm a firm believer, again, that with the leadership on this team, and it took Chara and Bergeron 20 minutes last night following the conclusion of the game to get to the podium for their post-game press conference.
There had to be a team.
That's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking that it had to have been some sort of conversation. And we heard it last year too, right? It was – I'm trying to remember when it was. I think it was after – I can't remember. Maybe I think it was the Toronto series, the first round. There was a team only meeting after losing, was it game five? And they fell behind 3-2. There was a players only meeting and
things, Columbus series.
The Columbus series, that's what it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was a players only meeting and things turned around. This is pretty much the same team. Okay? So it's not going to take much to hold the players only meeting and hope that guys get this message.
Yep.
So I'm not jumping off the Zakim yet, okay? I know Cam's got his toes off and he's got his heels.
He's dangling his legs.
He's got his heels on the edge. You know, I'm not. I've got faith in this team, and I think we're going to see a better performance in game four, whenever that is. I believe that these couple extra days allow the Bruins to sit here and allow this to stew and allow them to eat the shit sandwich that was fed to them last or served up to them on a silver platter last night from Tampa. Because I don't think they want a repeat of 2018. Because I think they will get crucified.
Yeah.
Locally here if that happens. Because again, you'll hear it. Oh, the Bruins get through round one. They win game one of the series, and then Tampa rips off four in a row and just kicks the shit out of the Bruins.
Yep, and it's happened looking last time. Dangerously close to that right now.
Happened last time.
Hasn't happened yet, but it's looking dangerously close.
So I'm trying to look at the glass half full here as opposed to half empty. So
someone's got to.
Exactly. Someone's got to have a little bit of the positivity here, just like somebody has to have the negativity and someone has to have the middle of the road.
We're rolling.
Okay, so we have all three specters covered.
Yep. Bringing you all different kinds of Boston Bruins fans. But here at Titletown Takes.
Connor, you mentioned it, and we'll finish up with this. The lineup last night was absolutely it was questioned from the moment it came out.
Yeah,
worst lineups I've ever seen.
You take out Clifton. Okay, Corrali, I guess, was the game time decision. I'm not sure what he's battling through. And again, so maybe these couple extra days.
Corrali just didn't play good in game two was the problem. I mean, sure, he had the tying assists, but he didn't do much else.
So, again, these couple extra days here allow him to figure out whatever the hell's going on, whether it's mentally or it's something that he can find on video that he sees needs to be fixed in his game. But get John Moore the hell out of the lineup.
Put Connor Clifton back in. Anymore. You've seen all you need to see from John Moore, even Jeremy Lozon to me, man. I mean, he's a more physical, bigger guy than Connor Clifton. But like I said, I said it in the post game one of the days. Well, I put it in the chat because I wasn't there. I was like, do you play Lozon over Grizzly, get some size, get some more physicality? It just didn't work. He just wasn't good. So put everything that's in your head away. Take it all out, shove it, throw it in the Charles River, all the way from Toronto, just chuck it away, okay? Play Bruins hockey. At the end of the day, play your game. Play your game. Herb Brooks said it in 1980. It's true to this day. You're not going to beat the Russians by playing Russian hockey. You're going to beat the Russians by playing USA hockey. Okay?
Grizzlick was the worst last night, by the way, -3.
Oh. I don't think the numbers – I
just thought I'd pull it up.
Doesn't mean he played the worst. Plus minus can sometimes be deceiving.
Krug -1, Lauzon -2, McAvoy -1, Moore -1. Carlo and Char were even.
That's actually crazy.
Granted, they might have been out there for power play goals.
The thing is here, right, too, you look at it with Chara, Tampa is just exposing him. They have zero problem going right at him on whatever side of the ice he is on. They see how – they realize how old he is. They see how he is struggling to get back up to speed or a resemblance of his speed and what he's been used to the last couple of years. We mentioned it last night, Cam, in the postgame. Connor, we were talking about it. Do you take Chara out? You don't, just because he's the leader, he's the captain. but you really got to do something here to.
Well, here's my thought: is who you going to replace him with?
And see,
you know what I mean.
That's the other side of the coin too. Is
yeah.
Who do you have to fill in?
I think Chara's overall good for the defense is a lot better than the overall good of John Moore and Jeremy Lozon. So,
Ekinainen.
Is he in the bubble?
Yeah, he's there.
Interesting.
Okay, there's a new wrinkle.
He's been there. He hasn't played.
We all saw how rookies do in this bubble. So maybe I'm you know a little reserved on that one.
All right, fellas.
Can't do much worse.
Let's get set to wrap this up because this has been a lengthy one. We have one thing left on the agenda, Connor.
Yes, we do. And you know, beacon of hope in this shitty episode of lots of sad and angry topics. We have the bag of fun. The bag of fun. Everybody's been waiting for the bag of fun question of the quarantine. Ian Beauchesne, what do you got, my friend?
All right, fellas. So I recently listened to the Rewatchables podcast on Spotify. Good show to listen to. I don't know if either of you guys listen to it, but it's with Bill Simmons. So they discuss movies from whenever, and it obviously the title talks about it itself, you know, movies that you can rewatch whenever just because of the quality of the movie and how good it is. So one of the more recent ones was The Sandlot, which one of our favorite movies here. Not quite Miracle in my books, but, you know. So today's bag of fun is if you could be a character in any sports movie, first of all, what movie are you picking? And what character would you pick to be in that movie? Who wants to go first?
I usually go first. Connor can go first.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, it's funny you brought up Sandlot, and I'm interested actually to see what character they chose because I would pick Mike Squint's Palidorus from The Sandlot.
Come on, Benny, man. The kid is a L7 weenie.
Why? So you could kiss Wendy Peppercorn?
Well, first of all, he's a funny guy. You know, he keeps the locker room loose and on the Sandlot. You know, he's you know, it's him and Benny the Jet, in my opinion, that are kind of the team leaders. You know, when they speak, the Sandlot crew listens. But yeah, I mean, who wouldn't want to? I don't know the number, but you know, he made the move on Wendy Peppercorn, and then they got married like 10 years later and had like 8 kids. So that's a good life, if you ask me. Plus, you know, an MLB baseball player and Benny the Jet. So that's my choice, boys. Wickes, what do you got?
I think there's only one answer. And yeah. Connor, I think you might already know this answer. I have his jersey up in my room. We went to the one time we went to the mall.
We went to that sports store
and I got the jersey. It doesn't fit very well and it's kind of uncomfortable. Who wouldn't want to be footstep Shane Falco from The Replacements?
Pain heals. Chicks dig scars. Glory lasts forever. Right on.
It's a good one.
Okay.
Good looking dude. Gets to have his moment of glory and gets the girl in the end. That sounds like a pretty good life to me.
Okay. Okay.
And I love The Replacements. It's such a good movie.
Good movie. Good movie.
It's kind of corny, but good.
Yeah. It's obviously a good movie because listening to Chicklets the other day, they had Kevin Hayes on, and he was talking about how there's a movie theater at one of the hotels up in Toronto and how they can rent out the movie theater. And he said that they had a movie night, and Hazy chose to put on The Replacements. That was the movie that they watched when they had the Flyers had a team movie night at the hotel. So obviously the movie connects with a lot of people in different ways. So
what about you, Beauchesne?
So Connor, I'm going down your road. I'm going to The Sandlot. Yeah.
Nice.
And I'm taking Ham.
You play ball like a girl! What did you say? You heard me.
Ham. Oh, because he goes a professional wrestler. Yeah.
No. Just because he is the greatest shit talker I have ever seen for a kid in a movie.
That's fair.
The absolute greatest. I mean, the lines that he has when they're taking on the little league team, the youth team at the Sandlot, and he's just sitting there behind the plate or whatever, and you know, hey, is that your sister out there in the outfield?
You know, good stuff, man.
Or if I had a dog as ugly as you, I'd shave its butt and teach it to walk backwards. Like the one-liners are great. I mean, and of course, who can forget you play ball like a girl? You know, that wasn't
him though. Oh yeah, it was him.
That's the line of the movie. Yep. Mm-hmm. You know, that whole exchange that him and the captain of the other baseball team have is great.
Yep.
Absolutely great. I mean,
you brush your teeth with your mama's toe jam.
Butt sniffer. Fart.
Licker.
Fart.
Or
no.
Something.
Butt
fart
licker. Smeller. Fart smeller.
Yeah. It's great. It's great. Yeah, the Sandlot's top 10
movie. Great. It's great. So, yeah, I'm going with him. Also, because growing up playing baseball as a kid, I was a catcher and watching
catcher
it.
Catcher gang.
Yeah, it was, you know. Oh, how I longed for the opportunity to sit there and shit talk somebody when they stepped up to bat like he did. But, you know, unfortunately, he was frowned upon.
Yeah.
Umpires would turn around and tell you, hey, knock it off. You know, you couldn't have as much fun on the baseball diamond playing a little league as you could playing baseball on the Sandlot. But with that said, yes, I am taking Ham. He won the movie, in my opinion. He is the character of the movie.
Yeah, so, it's fair. Where would the Sandlot be without Ham?
Seriously, think about it. I mean, he teaches Smalls about
how to s'mores. Yep.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. When the pool scene when he walks out and he's looking at the girls laying there sunbathing and he's like,
yeah.
Hey lady, and he blows them. Oh, yeah. Oh yeah.
Confidence.
Absolutely.
Stain
great.
You can't wipe off.
And for a big kid too. Right. And for a big kid too. I related to that as someone who was a little bit on the heavier side as a younger kid. So there were a lot of similarities between me and Ham. So Ham gets my pick. For if I could be a character at a baseball in a movie, a sports movie, that's who I'd go with.
That's good stuff, man.
So, all right, fellas, I think that about does it here for us today. This is a lengthy one,
hefty one.
But yeah, once
it
again,
it's like 3 hours.
we had a lot to get out.
Yeah, well, we haven't had an epi in a little bit here, so.
But once again, huge thanks to Freddie Coleman from ESPN Radio joining us here today. We hope you all enjoyed that interview as much as we did. We hope you enjoyed the episode. Again, stay on the lookout for pre- and post-game thoughts as we move along in this postseason with the Bruins.
Pre, maybe post-game.
No.
Yeah, we don't know what game we're going to get.
That's also very true.
If the Bruins try, we'll try. How about that?
That's fair enough. So, hold on, fellas. Do you want to explain to the people at home that might be tuning in what's going on with this year?
Yeah. So, you know, what we've understood is, you know, on our outros, Ian always does his classic, you know, from, you know, everyone here at Titletown Takes, I'm your host, Ian Beauchesne. Lights out. Good night. And, you know, I personally felt a little lonely when that happened. You know, he's doing his little thing. And he's talking and he's, you know, stealing the show as he does. He's great at what he does. But me and Cam, you know, behind the scenes, need to have a little fun with it. So as soon as he starts his outro every episode, me and Cam start the outro train going. And as soon as lights out goes, we do it with him. And we're a team here at Titletown Takes. So that's how she rolls.
All right. That'll do it for us here. Again, stay tuned for pre and post game, pregame, and maybe post game, depending on outcomes. For my co-hosts, Connor Powell, Cameron Urbowicz, for our guest, Freddie Coleman of ESPN Radio, my name's Ian Beauchesne. Have a good weekend. Lights out. Good night. I'm going to tell you a story.